Good morning and welcome to the 23rd meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. Our first item of business this morning is an evidence session on local government spending on education and children's services to help us inform the committee's pre-budget scrutiny. Can I welcome Dr. Douglas Hutchison, President of the Association of Directors of Education in Scotland and Executive Director of Education from Glasgow City Council. Morning. Carrie Lindsay, Executive Officer, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland. And Kirsty Flanagan, Director of Finance, Argyll and Bute Council, who is representing SIPFA, Local Government Directors of Finance Scotland. So thank you all for joining us this morning. We do have a lot of ground to cover, so I'm going to move straight to questions from members. And the first member this morning is Michelle Thompson. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for joining us. It's a question for all of the panel, and perhaps arguably it's a framing one. I'm also a member of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, so I'm very interested in the specifics of how the Ferity House Agreement will work in terms of process. Now, just to framing, the issue with Scottish Government financing is deeply affected by late decision-making of the UK Government, and you may have seen the recent letter from the Welsh Government complaining about the late UK autumn statement. That's also had an effect on the Scottish Government, and it's been pushed back to the 22nd of November, making the original planned budget date of 14th of December no longer realistic. So my question is, what is your understanding thus far of how the financial elements will work in terms of the flow through and late decision making and processes from the UK government? Anyone can go first, perhaps. Dr. Hutchison, you might like to go first, but I know you have an interest, both Carrie and Kirsty.
I'd have to be honest and say it's not a question I'm particularly familiar with. I mean, I have a broad understanding of the Verity House Agreement and the principles of the Verity House Agreement, but my understanding is we're still working through those, and that's more likely a question that should be directed to COSLA, I suspect, okay. Who would be involved in discussions on behalf of local authorities. Okay. So I have a broad understanding of Verity House, what the implications are, but my understanding is we're still working through the Verity House Agreement. But in terms of any late decisions from the UK government, I'm not in a position to comment on that. Okay. I'm not sure if Kirsty is.
I was placing it on mute there. Yeah, at the moment, as part of the Verity House Agreement, we are looking at the in-year transfers and the transfers, you know, from all the portfolios. So we're interested to see how that progresses. And also there is the presumption of no ring fencing or no direction. So I'm not quite sure how the UK government position affects that. I suppose the overall quantum of funding, I suppose, affects that. So I think we just need to see the working out of the Verity House Agreement and how that no ring fencing and no direction will work for the total quantum of finances that will come to Scotland. But yeah, I agree the late announcement of the funding puts extreme pressure on trying to kind of pull together a budget at a late stage, and also the one-year budgets is not helpful either. We've been pushing for multi-year budgets for some time now that would allow us to plan ahead for financial sustainability, and the one-year budgets are not helpful at all.
Yeah, and I think that's a commonly understood term, and it came up yesterday in our finance committee that largely the UK government have been working to a one-year budget process, which flows through, of course, to the Scottish government as well. So it sounds to me, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but in terms of where the strategic review group is in understanding the detail of both these things, it's still fairly early doors, because it's not just the initial budget settlement, it's in-year changes as well, of which we've seen quite a bit. That affects and will have, I imagine, or could have an impact on ring fencing because there's a lack of visibility and transparency of money coming through. Am I putting words in your mouth? Or
no, I think that's that. Yeah, no, I would agree with that. Yeah.
Okay, Carrie, last comment from yourself.
think most things have probably been said, but maybe just to reiterate that anything that's late in terms of discussions that need to happen at local authority level makes it challenging. If you don't know what your quantum is, you're not quite sure yet what your outcomes are in the outcomes framework for Verity House, and you're not quite sure what the conditions are going to be around the actual funding, then it does, the lateness of that always has an impact, because then things are perhaps not as clear as it could be if you've got a longer lead-in time. So I think that, that would be the case.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener.
Can I bring in Ben McPherson, who's got some other questions on this theme, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, all. Building on what has just been asked by my colleague Michelle Thompson, thinking back to pre-Verity House and in recent years, one of the reasons, in fact, one of the main reasons for ring fencing and direction was because of political pressure being applied on the Scottish Government by opposition parties and others to meet certain policy obligations that required local government to be part, a significant part, and the main part of that delivery. So as we move post Verity House and open up the flexibility and remove the ring fencing and direction, which I support, just for clarity, in your view, what should the Scottish Government's role be if a local authority is failing to improve outcomes in an area of national priority, such as education?
Who are you directing that to first?
Does anyone want to take that first? Carrie, would you want to?
Maybe Lindsay? Dr. Hutchison. I'm not sure. Someone.
Yeah, I'll take that.
Thank you, Dr. Hutchison.
I mean, there has been reference to, in some ways, this question in one of the OECD reports. I think it was the 2015 OECD report, where it said that the role of Scottish Government is to set the overall, in terms of education, is to set the overall strategic direction and policy direction. But delivery is at local authority, and where that national comes up short is getting through the classroom door. I think that phrase might even be mentioned in the document. And so where there is a failure, I think there are various mechanisms in the system to address that. If there's a failure in relation to education, there is legislation that the inspector can go in and inspect a local authority, for example, if it's failing in its duties in relation to education. That has rarely been used, but it is available. Equally, there's Audit Scotland have carried out, you know, their best value reviews, which again highlight where there are weaknesses. So there are various safety mechanisms within the system which are available to Scottish ministers to direct, for example. So overall, it's the role of government, I mean, because they're elected on a manifesto, it's right that they deliver their manifesto. We live and operate in a parliamentary democracy, that's right. So they deliver their manifesto commitments, they set the policy direction. That delivery is local. Where that delivery is failing, or where a local education authority is failing, then it would be appropriate for Scottish Government to intervene, and that can be done in various ways that I've outlined.
Thank you. So in a scenario like that, and I'm very familiar with the best value report process and the considerations thereafter around how government, and indeed in this instance with education inspectorate, should be engaging with local authority, the specific local authority, both at a political and an official level, and it seems to be that's what you've outlined would be the right course for Scottish ministers, and also for parliamentary pressure to be directed.
Do you want to come in? It's Carrie Lindsay, sorry.
Yeah, thanks. Just to add to that, I suppose that, I mean, the word failing is quite a pejorative term, and probably we would say that there are different challenges for different local authorities at different points for a whole range of reasons. But I think every local authority will have improvement processes already in place, and if there are things that are not reaching the targets, and I suppose the Verity House Agreement and the outcomes framework will be a way of being able to, I suppose, give support where that's required if people are finding that challenge in particular areas. And that in ADES, we support local authorities in that way too. So if people are asking each other, that we do that very much on a collaborative basis, we would support people within the local authority. And I think that Education Scotland have a role within either the RICS or Education Scotland themselves to be able to do that too. And I think that we have quite good systems in place to allow that to happen. Obviously, the Scottish Government need to look at the outcomes, and they would, obviously there are things that they can use, as Douglas has outlined already, if they feel that there's something more further that's required.
Thank you. Thanks for both of your reflections. That was helpful.
Pam Douglas, did you have a brief supplementary on this, please?
Yes, I do. Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much, panel, for that this morning. Given the Verity House Agreement, do you have any concerns about the overall quantum available to you for education locally? And are you aware already of stretched budgets using other budgets such as PEF to plug holes that exist in core budgets across the piece?
Who would... Carrie, do you want to come in, or is that more for Kirsty? I'm not...
Kirsty might want to go first.
Kirsty can go first.
I think... We're concerned that budgets are stretched right across local government because there just isn't enough budget to do everything that we want to do. The Verity House Agreement, I think that's a positive step forward because of the relaxing of the ring fencing and direction. And if they take one of the education ring fencing and it's the kind of absolute teacher numbers, you could get into a situation there that's not providing value for money or efficiency, but certainly where local authorities are in a declining school role and you're trying to maintain an absolute number. So for me, it's the overall quantum of funding overall needs to be looked at, not just within education. And I think the relaxing of ring fencing might help, but obviously we still need to keep a focus on the outcomes, and I think councils were doing that prior to bringing in that absolute teacher number ring fencing. So
I know we've got members that are going to ask some questions around that specific topic later, Kirsty, so we can get into more detail then. Thank you. Bill Kidd, can I... Or are we okay with that response? I'm just checking. I'm going to move on to Bill Kidd now. Thank you. Thank you.
Right, thank you very much. And just basically around that there, actually, in education spend and its protection, other than free school meals, does the panel get any examples of ring-fenced, I'm talking about that, or earmarked funds where the government has not uprated its contribution in line with inflation? So government funding of ring-fencing and earmarks, any examples where you don't believe that this has been kept up in line with inflation?
Did you say not excluding free school meals? Because free school meals is probably the best example of where we get an allocation to implement a policy, but it's never sustainable in the long term. And free school meals is a perfect example because all of us round the table know how much cost of living is now and the increase.
I think we're looking for another example. So Carrie's got something, I think.
Okay.
Thanks anyway. Thank you.
Carrie,
I was just thinking in terms of the ELC and the 1140 hours and the PVI payments, that I think that that's an example where... to keep that whole project going to deliver the 1140 hours, then obviously the uplift for PVI has seemed to be necessary, possibly. And I think that that isn't because of inflation, but the budget doesn't match that. So that would be another example.
Right. Well, thank you. I mean, as was said by Kirsty there, you know that we know the situation with free school meals and whether it's kept up with ring fencing and all that sort of thing. But it's just to find out if there's other areas such as been mentioned. That was it, basically. Yeah, thanks.
Okay, we're powering through. Sticking on that subject of early learning and that subject of or terminology ring fencing, okay, do you get a sense that the ring fence grants are covering the support that ELC cover that we're actually needing and the cost of actually delivering the expanded ELC offer?
So there's been some changes to the funding over the last 3 years in particular, and I think that because the models were in place incrementally, then I think that it's taken some time for local authorities to have their absolute models in place. And then also because there's a biannual survey from parents about what is required. So there are then some changes, and some models are more expensive than others. So for an actual quantum, it's quite difficult to continue to deliver almost a, you know, parent-led system where they're looking for particular things. So I think that there have been real challenges in being able to deliver that policy agenda. And particularly if we're moving on to two-year-olds and one-year-olds, which we're not really clear about whether or not the policy is going to be implemented from the government from that perspective. So again, there would be big implications for two-year-olds and one-year-olds if that were to be the case, that there wouldn't be enough in that budget.
So sticking on that 2 and 1 year olds before anyone else may want to come in, the data sharing agreement has just taken, you know, between HMRC and the DWP to identify the 2 year olds that are eligible for that ELC. So what progress has been made in actually reaching those families, and what are the anticipated cost implications, and how do you think that's going to all get funded within that envelope that we have?
Yeah, again, over the last 3 years, we've seen a significant increase in the two-year-old uptake. Some parents, of course, of two-year-olds and one-year-olds don't want to actually take up their places. So I think it's, you know, it'd be helpful to see from the DWP, and that's something we've been asking for quite some time, because that did exist and happen in England, and we weren't able to access that information. So I think that there will be an impact, definitely, where there are perhaps families who weren't aware that they were able to access. And all of these budgets were aligned to what were given on birth rates and what the percentage, I suppose, expectation of uptake would be, where now we'll have a much firmer idea of the numbers, and that might have a significant implication.
So is that data not yet at the local authority level yet?
It's just starting now.
Just starting to come through to you now?
Yeah.
Okay, that's fine. Can I move to questions from my colleague Willie Rennie now, please?
I'm interested in how you view the state of the PVI sector, the private, voluntary and independent sector for early learning and childcare. What do you think the pressures are? Perhaps Carrie could talk through that first.
Yeah, I think it's always, I mean, it's a, you know, we can't deliver 1140 hours without the PVI sector, and we really value, and I suppose we value because they are often much more flexible, that they can do different things because they're small organisations rather than large organisations. So I think that there's absolutely no doubt that, you know, we want to work in partnership with them. I think there are real challenges in terms of the costs, so inflation for them, staffing costs, minimum wage. You know, there have been a range of things that they've been expected to be able to deliver, and that has made it challenging for them to have business cases that stack up. The other thing with the PVI sector is that some of those organisations are very small organisations, and they don't have a sustainable management committee, because often the parents will change. So that becomes a real problem, that they have people who come in who don't have the experience. And now we're seeing, obviously, the child minding being brought into that as well. And I think that, you know, with individuals to try to support them, there's a lot required from the local authority perspective to support the PVI sector to make sure that the quality is of a standard that is acceptable. And obviously now one of the recommendations is that we have to have a good or above to be able to stay in partnership with a local authority. So there's a lot required from a local authority perspective to support them. And sometimes those are hidden costs. So sometimes the PVI sector don't always see the support because it's not monetary, it's not coming through as an amount per pupil or per child. So I think that sometimes those hidden costs are not recognised as much as perhaps they could be. I'll give you a flavour.
Do you recognise the argument that there is a significant difference in the fees that are paid for council nurseries versus the PVI sector? Do you recognise that?
I think it's a hard question to answer because of just some of what I've said, yeah. Because there are a whole range of things that come from the local authority to the PVI sector.
But does that really amount to that difference?
I think they're completely different setups. They're different structures. You know, council's not working on the same type of business case that those PVI sectors are. So I think it's a challenging question to answer in that way.
Because, yeah, I mean, the outcome seems to be that the PVI sector are losing quite significant numbers of experienced staff because they're not able to retain them because they can't pay the rates competitive with other, you know, either inside or outside the sector. And they are really worried about the future of the sector. Do you not recognise that?
I think that's always been said. I mean, and all the time I've been involved in early years,
which is
many years.
Yeah.
But what I was going to go on to say is that I don't actually see that in reality as such. So, for example, modern apprenticeships, which we run through PVI sector as well as within local authorities, they often will retain their staff that way. A lot of local authorities will have agreements to be able to support the staffing, to help them with the colleges to make sure that they are accessing enough staff. The way that the system is currently set up, that there are different differentials in the payment structures, absolutely. That happens in lots of things.
I'm really disappointed with this response. Matthew Sweeney from COSLA before last year, he acknowledged that there was a significant difference and it was agreed right at the beginning between government and local authorities that that would happen. And I think we're seeing real threats to the sector now. It's not, they are getting staff, it's just keeping the experienced staff. And I really worry about the integrity of the bodies now, that we will get perhaps care inspectorate reports in future that indicate we've not managed to keep up with the standards that you've indicated earlier. I'm disappointed you don't recognise that.
I don't think I said I didn't recognise that there is a differential. I think I did say that. I think that what we are trying to do is to make sure that we're supporting the sector in a way that they can survive, because I think, as I said in my earlier comment, is that it is a partnership that we need to work jointly together to deliver this. And I think that's why there have been a number of groups that have looked at what do we need to provide, and it's been really difficult to actually have a figure or an amount that is required, and whether it is just about staffing or it's about all of the other things that are offered to keep these organisations being able to deliver their services.
Dr Hutchison wants to come in to respond to some of those, and I've got a small supplementary as well on this.
It was really just to say, convener, in response to Mr Rennie, his disappointment. This is a discussion and an argument that probably comes up on an annual basis when local authorities are required to set the sustainable rate. And I absolutely acknowledge that there are significant differences between PVI and local authority. But part of that is, in a sense, historical. If we were starting from a blank sheet in terms of early years, then there would be much more equity. However, we didn't start from a blank sheet. There already were partner providers, third sector organisations, a range of organisations providing early learning and childcare who didn't have the commitments that local authorities have in relation to pension fund and various other commitments, a local government commitment to real living wage, for example. So there already was a differential at the very beginning, which has almost become baked in and makes it very challenging. And these discussions, these arguments come up every year. And that's partly why there is this discussion about should we set a national rate in terms of the sustainable rate.
You're absolutely right. I mean, it is historical and it is kind of baked in. But the expectations on the PVI sector are almost exactly the same as those in council nurseries. They're expected to get the same service on both sides in terms of care, but also education. So you're right, but it doesn't make it right. And we do need to work a plan to bring them closer together, don't we? Yeah. Do we need to bring them closer together?
That's the issue that comes up on an annual basis in terms of agreeing a sustainable rate, and that's part of the discussion about whether that should be set nationally, because that's more likely to bring them closer together. But I think it's a significant task.
Can I ask specifically on the rates that the local authorities pass down to the PVI sector? There is a variation across the different local authorities about what they pay for over twos and under twos. And you've already mentioned, we know that the cost of for under twos in terms of ratios of staff are higher. There is a local health authority, in fact, the one that we're sitting in, the boundary of City of Edinburgh, pay the same, irrespective of the age of the child. And I'm wondering how can that be perceived to be fair to put that pressure on a PVI sector when they're not getting the additional resource that's required to fund to support the under two sector? So I'm wondering if you want to comment on that.
So I think it's difficult to comment on a particular local authority and their.
It's not just Edinburgh,
that
you're seeing variation.
But yeah. I think that, as I said earlier in answer to Mr Rennie's question, that there are different things that are offered as well as the sustainable rate. And I think that in some places they will offer teacher support, where in other places they will say that the teacher is part of the PVI sector, it's their responsibility. So there are a whole range of different ways that people make up those costs and how they make
justify the fact they're not passing the adequate funding on to the PVI sector. Okay. I now have some... Sorry? No,
sorry, convener. It was really... The variation in funding. I moved from a local authority with a large rural hinterland to Glasgow City Council, which doesn't have that. And so the cost pressures are different in terms of funding. So, for example, if you're providing childcare down in Ballantrae, you might only have three children, but you still need to have two members of staff. So it is proportionately more expensive in the rural areas. And I didn't tend to find PVI sector making provision, you know, up a glen or down in Ballantrae. They tended to be in centres of population. So the variations across the country are understandable, and that's why there's a challenge in setting a national rate. There is a huge difference between a fairly efficient system like Glasgow, where the early year centres are largely full and largely the staffing ratios are efficient, compared to rural local authorities where there's almost a built-in inefficiency because you've got small numbers of children but are required to have certain numbers of staff, which make it more expensive.
Okay, thank you for those. I'm going to switch over a little bit to more primary and secondary schools. And when we have a look at some of the figures, I'm just wondering if you could... perhaps we come to Kirsty first. What factors are there that are meaning that in real terms the net spend on schools is planned to be higher this year than 2019-20? And then I suppose an adjunct to that is, why is there a planned reduction, what appears to be a planned reduction, in the real terms spend between 2022-23 and then the year we're in now, 23-24? Are you able to take that one first, Kirsty?
Yeah, I maybe have to just ask you the second question again. But the net spend in schools is higher. Okay. I suppose, you know, we're in a time of high inflation. So, you know, a big proportion of the expenditure in education, about half of the expenditure in education, is employee-related expenditure. And we've seen significant pay rises there. And not only that, we've had high levels of inflation for utilities and other costs that schools have to spend. So that's really the reasons, down to the increase in spending. What was your question about the real...
Just check. Why is there a planned reduction in the real term spend between 2022-23 and
23-24? I'm not sure if I know...
quite get that question.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I know where the... I don't have the figures in front of me of that real term reduction. Okay.
We'll follow up in writing with that one. I think Kirsty might be the best. And we've got some data that sits behind this that, unless Carrie wants to come in slightly on either of those.
Yeah, I was just going to come in reduction in term, particularly in primary spend, that what we have seen is that there is a significant reduction in births across Scotland. Some local authorities are looking at, you know, 500, 600 less births a year over the last few years. So what we've seen is that the bulge from primary is now in secondary, so the spend is higher in secondary, and I think you'll see that that's still going up, but the primary spend is coming down because there aren't as many children that are actually attending the schools, which makes it less efficient as well when you're trying to manage your budget in that way.
Okay, thank you. Great. Can we move now to questions from my colleague Ruth McGuire, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. I'd like to talk about particular costs, teaching costs and other staffing costs. And if I can go to Kirsty Flanagan first. You mentioned the protection of teacher numbers. We've spoken before in this committee about the situation of some local authorities where pupil roll is falling, yet they're expected to maintain teacher numbers. In my own local authority area, they've also lost attainment challenge funding, which adds additional pressure. Can you speak a little bit about the opportunity costs of having to maintain teacher numbers and what that looks like for children and young people in schools where that's the case?
Kind of what I said earlier, I'm not sure if it answers the kind of opportunity cost, but what I said earlier, if we're trying to maintain the kind of absolute teacher numbers, it is to the detriment of other services right across local government portfolio, because we're seeing in education costs increasing in education, but you'll see in most other portfolios there's a reduction because they have to take the burden of the cost savings due to the real terms decrease that we're seeing in the overall quantum of funding. So I think the protection of teacher numbers, and I know I have education colleagues here, and obviously we want to maintain the good schooling, but the maintaining of the actual numbers rather than the pupil teacher ratio that we used to had. I'm not saying that was a perfect formula either, but it did recognise the school role there. So
okay, so maybe move on to reflections from Addis. I don't know if Carrie Lindsay wants to come in on. Douglas Hutchinson.
Go first, I'll come after.
Okay.
I would agree with Kirsty. The focus on absolute teacher numbers is a challenge. You know, it's been done this year. It was done previously when Mr. Russell was Cabinet Secretary. There was a year where we had to focus on absolute teacher numbers, and it's difficult to see the logic of it if you're in a local authority with a declining role compared to if you're in, you know, West Lothian with an increasing role in building new schools. You're almost having to falsely keep teachers that are supernumerary because you have to focus on absolute teacher numbers. I just struggle to see the logic of it. A pupil-teacher ratio I can understand. But if you've got a falling role and you're forced to keep teachers, then the opportunity costs then become clear, because I've been head of education or director now for 10 years, and in almost every one of those 10 years, probably with the exception of the COVID years when there seemed to be lots of money, I have been involved in reducing the budget in education, having to find savings because the council's overall budget has reduced. And so if we're protecting teachers, then the burden of savings falls on others, like support for learning workers, educational psychologists, homeschool liaison workers, technician support services. There's a range of admin staff, you know, school offices. There are a range of people without whom education can't function. And if we protect one group, albeit a very important and very valued group, then the burden of savings falls heavier on others within education. And if that's true of education, it's true more generally of councils, because education depends on other council services in order to operate. Mm-hmm. And the burden of savings falls significantly more heavily on other parts of the council if education is protected. And obviously, the Director of Education, happy that education is protected, but I also recognise the impact that has on other services. I mean, there will hardly be a school in Scotland more than, 15 or 20 years old that doesn't have some kind of backlog maintenance that goes with it. So if we're reducing other council services, then we are reducing the money available for repairs and renewals of our school buildings, for example.
Thank you for that. I suppose I'd be interested to hear what... you spoke there about Glasgow City Council reducing education budget. I know there are other local authorities who have, even throughout these really challenging times, protected the education budget. So it'd be good to hear what within education the money could be invested in and what that would look like for children and young people in the education system. I suppose going back to the kind of Verity House agreement side of things and the priorities for us in terms of that, it'd be interesting to hear reflections on where that money might be invested and how that would benefit children and young people.
I'm happy to say something on that. I think that if you're in the luxury position of being able to maintain the education budget without having to offer lots up, and you don't have teacher numbers to keep, then there are lots of things that some local authorities have done. They've kept their teacher numbers, but they've also invested. So, but if you had that flexibility, I think there are a number of local authorities have done things like they've put early years officers into their primary one classes to try to look at how they support communication and socialisation after COVID, which has been quite challenging in the early years. Some people have put in staff to support attendance because, again, we've seen that the attendance of pupils has been a bit challenging since COVID. So people have used that budget, or if they've had extra budget, if they've had to keep their teacher numbers, but it's that flexibility it would give you to use other members of staff who are not teachers. Now, teachers are absolutely essential to the business of teaching and learning, but there are lots of other things that families and children and young people need support with. Another example would be that people have invested more in their counselling services, their play therapy, their art therapy, their support for our young people who are really struggling and having some difficult times in school. So I suppose it would give that type of flexibility.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Generally, the pay of teachers and local government employees is subject to negotiations between COSLA, local authorities and trade unions. However, in recent years, the Scottish Government has stepped in to fund uplifts in pay. What role is there for the Scottish Government in relation to the pay of local authority workers?
Kirsty first,
Kirsty's smiling, so yeah, we should.
That's an interesting question, because obviously we're in that very much in the negotiations for non-teaching staff at the moment. I think the Verity House agreement outlines that it's a negotiation for non-teachers with COSLA and the trade unions. However, we are seeing pressure, and we saw pressure from Scottish Government to increase the pay. So I suppose the role of the Scottish Government then is, if they, you know, if they want the pay increased, then we need additional funding to support that, because, you know, we've only got so much money that we can put into the pay award. And I know that additional funding was put into the teachers' pay award last year, and we did get additional funding into our SGC negotiations as well, which was helpful. But it's the ongoing cost of that as well. So, you know, you get a one-year injection of that, but then there's the inflationary aspect that gives you a bigger hit in future years. So what I think your question was, what role does Scottish Government play in that? I'm not entirely sure what role they really should play in these sort of negotiations, but I know that they have intervened in the past.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if any of the other panel members wish to come in. No?
Not on that one.
No. Okay, thank you. That was helpful.
Can I move over to supplementary from Ben McPherson, please?
Thanks, Convener. Just building on what Ruth Maguire has asked, I thought the answer from yourself, Dr. Hutchison, and then the elaboration from Carrie Lindsay about teacher numbers was really interesting and important. I just wanted to absolutely be clear that you think consideration, whether that's in our public discourse, our media commentary, our analysis, should be about pupil-teacher ratio rather than teacher numbers. Was I correct in taking that as your overarching message?
That would certainly be my view, that there's a logic to a pupil-teacher ratio, because if collectively there's a decision that we should aspire to a particular ratio, whatever that is, that makes sense. Because as your number of pupils declines, if you're in a falling roll situation because the population in that part of the country is declining, then you don't need as many teachers. So as Some teachers retire, they're not replaced, for example, or leave the profession or whatever. They're not replaced. But the pupil-teacher ratio is maintained. But if the focus is on absolute numbers, then you're in a declining role. So, you know, 1 year your numbers go down. Our primary numbers have gone down by several hundred, but our secondary numbers in Glasgow have gone up by several hundred. So it has almost netted itself off. But if you're in a the main issue is where you're in a declining role situation. But as it was mentioned, there are things that are funded, but they're funded in a flat cash basis. For example, the Strategic Equity Fund is flat cash. The Pupil Equity Fund is flat cash. So if I could buy 10 teachers last year with a pay rise, I can't buy 10 teachers this year, but I'm still required to maintain teacher numbers as an absolute. That doesn't make sense. So anyway, in broad terms, a focus on pupil-teacher ratio, there's a logic to it which people can understand. I struggle to understand the logic of absolute numbers.
Okay. Thank you for that emphasis and clarification. Sorry, Kirsty Fanning.
I just want to come in and I would agree there is a logic to the pupil-teacher ratio over above pupil numbers. And I was just kind of picking out the Verity House agreement there, where it's talking about we'd focus on the achievement of better outcomes. I still think the pupil-teacher ratio is an input measure, you know, rather than focusing on the outputs and the outcomes. So whether it's, I think it's better than the absolute teacher numbers, but I think there should be more of a focus on the outcomes.
Thank you.
Carrying on the theme about numbers and teacher stuff, I'm going to bring in Willie Rennie, please.
So why do we still have so many teachers on short-term contracts? Who wants to answer? Douglas, do you want to have a go?
I would be interested to see the data. I'm not clear that... I, as I sit here, don't know whether there are more now than there were previously. I know that in Glasgow we have around 900 who were used for supply last year. We have about 300, just over 300 in fixed-term contracts. Those fixed-term contracts, I'm presuming, are covering maternity leave, but we have a number of supply teachers to cover short-term absences or teachers on secondment. But I don't know. I would have to look at year-on-year figures. I mean, I've certainly seen media reports, but I don't know what they're based on. So I would need to see the data in order to come to a decision, a view on whether the reality is we have more or less now. Overall, it would be a matter for the kind of National Workforce Planning Group in terms of numbers going into initial teacher education, whether there are likely to be posts for them at the end of it. We have got that right sometimes, we have got that wrong sometimes. I mean, when I started off as Head of Education in South Ayrshire around about 2014-15, you could not get a supply teacher for love nor money because the numbers going into initial teacher education had been reduced drastically due to negative headlines of unemployed teachers. And so the numbers going in were reduced significantly. That led to a crisis in terms of, not only short-term supply, it was really challenging at that time to get English teachers, for example. So it is a matter for a National Workforce Planning Group, and they take account of a broad range of indicators, but sometimes it's maybe too few or too many. But I, without the data, I couldn't answer.
Carrie, do you have a...
I would agree with what Douglas said. It's hard to answer without the data. I think that obviously we have a significant female population, so there are always a number of maternity leaves, and obviously they're always filled with a temporary post. There are also people who might come in through the year that will come into a post but on a temporary basis in that school. And I think sometimes there's a bit of a, I don't know, misnomer is maybe the right word, that people don't really understand that sometimes you're still full-time but you're temporary to that school. But then when you, at the end of that year, you then need to go into a permanent post. So people think that then there are lots of posts that are then vacant, but they're not, you're just moving people around. So I think that in that respect, people often think that when they see these posts becoming available, that they're, you know, they're not available to them to apply for. But I do think that there are significant challenges in trying to fill particular subjects. But we know that at the moment with primary schools that we have, you know, many more primary staff than are required at the current time. In secondary, in particular subjects, we have a real problem. So the supply staff, as Douglas said, for primary is in a really healthy position. But that does mean that those people are on temporary contracts and not on permanent contracts.
So in that light, do you think we're training too many, or educating too many primary school teachers?
I think that's for the workforce planning group, obviously, that question. I think that is what they look at. And I mean, I've been involved in education, as is Douglas, for many, many years. And we have seen that when the demographic of society changes, and I think that this is probably was a bit less obvious because I think the pandemic has had an impact on people's size of families or when they start their families. So I think that there has been a significant shift in terms of the birth rate over the last few years, which we're now seeing to come into the organisations.
You will have received communications letters that I've received from primary school teachers who gave up other careers or have been really passionate about teaching young people. And their dreams have been torn away from them because there's either a series of short-term contracts, sometimes up to 6 years, and others who just can't find a job at all. We've not got it right just now, have we? I know it's a difficult balancing act, I get that, and it goes in cycles, but just now it's particularly bad, isn't it?
Again, without the data in front of us to know over the last few years what that's looked like, I think anecdotally there probably are stories about people who are in exactly the situations that you talk about, but there equally be people who have got permanent jobs and that who are really comfortable that they have gone through that training. I think for periods of time within education, people have expected to go into supply first and then to go into permanent jobs, but I think because of the probationer system that people, there's almost an expectation that if you've got a probationer post that you then will get a permanent job. It's a bit like a training for your permanent role. And there's maybe something that we need to do just around helping the profession understand that it's not an automatic right then to a permanent job at the end of that. Because I think some of the people who are coming out of university, that's their belief, that's what they actually feel is a right for them.
Liam Kerr, you want to come in on this, and then Bill Kidd does as well.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just a very brief question on numbers and absolute numbers. Several of my colleagues and I were at a very good event last night around engineering. And arising from that, I wonder, is there a concern that when we talk about overall numbers and changes in that due to perhaps declining roles, that actually masks specific challenges, such as we heard last night, the fact that there are 300 fewer English teachers, 300 fewer maths teachers, 178 fewer computer science teachers than there were in 2008, which presumably are the sort of things we absolutely need to be focusing on if we are to have a future where we are sufficiently upskilled in STEM subjects and for things like engineering.
Dr. Hutchison.
There may be a reason why there are fewer English teachers and maths teachers compared to 2008, and it may be population related. I mean, it's within living memory that there were probably 59 secondary schools in Glasgow. There are now 30 secondary schools in Glasgow because the population has shifted. So without looking at the population in 2008 and comparing it to now, it would be difficult to comment on absolute teacher numbers. However, generally, I would agree with you that there are some areas where there are concerns. Computing teachers is a real challenge. Technical teachers at the moment is another area of challenge. Home economics teachers in secondary school are difficult to find. Generally speaking, we can fill all our vacancies from our probationers, which is why they're interviewed, given a score, and then allocated. But the two areas where we have struggled to fill all our vacancies this year would be maths and technical teachers. And I do know that computing science is a challenge, as is home economics. So there are some areas where the subjects are harder to fill. And you're right, they're absolutely key areas in terms of STEM, careers that we would want young people to be developing their skills in those areas. So, yes, there are some challenges within the overall picture, you're right.
Very grateful.
Lindsay, I think, wants to respond to some of those that question as well.
Briefly, just to add to that, that there are schemes to attract STEM subject teachers in so that they can get bursaries and various things. So I think there is a real acknowledgement that that is a difficulty. And I suppose the other point just to make is that we are seeing in some parts of Scotland where it's impossible to get subject specialists, that people just don't want to move to those particular parts of Scotland. And I think that, you know, in places like Aberdeenshire and Aberdeen, they've really struggled to get people to move up, as we would class it in Scotland. And I think that that's something that, you know, we do have to consider as part of the workforce planning group, about how we encourage people not just to want to be in the central belt, where it is much easier to get subjects filled, but even there it's not as easy as it used to be.
Pam Duncan Clancy, over to you now, please.
Thank you, convener. If it's okay, convener, can I just indulge in one point about what has just been said from Carrie Lindsay and Dr. Hutchison? Why do you think there is that reduction or difficulty in recruiting maths, technical, and computing teachers?
Dr. Hutchison.
I presume because if you've got a STEM degree, there might be more attractive options elsewhere. That would be my guess, but I don't know.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm moving on now to free school meal provision. And my first question is around the current provision for primary one to primary five. Local government put a joint submission into the Finance and Public Administration Committee to say there was a shortfall in funding for that. Can the panel describe what that shortfall is and explain how it's been funded?
I'm not sure. Do you mean quantum of what it is? I would imagine that the shortfall in the funding is all around the inflationary aspects of free school meal provision, which I touched on that earlier. We're all finding in our pockets when we go to the supermarket, things are way more expensive. And when that policy commitment was given out, as with many policy commitments, we get it funded in the first year and that funding is then rolled forward. It's not inflated and that is an area of severe inflation.
So what are councils doing about it to meet the provision?
They're having to make savings elsewhere in other service areas in order to maintain that service provision.
And do you know where those savings are broadly coming from across the piece?
No, I mean, it'll vary across authority to authority. So I couldn't really answer that. But, I mean, one would assume it'll not be directly linked. You'll not be saying, well, I'm going to cut the roads because I'm having to meet the inflation free school meals. It'll just be across the broad range of services.
Does the panel have an understanding of what the cost for extending the free school meal provision into primary six and seven will be, and how the panel think that will be funded?
I think we're working that information, pulling together that information at this moment in time. I think we could have capital costs as well as increased revenue costs, because there might be expansions to kitchens that are required. So, you know, and I know that when that was talked about a couple of years ago and then it was put on delay, there wasn't enough funding that had been set aside for that. So I don't know what we need at this moment in time. I think that information gathering exercise is taking place just now. But we would need to have it fully funded in order to deliver on that.
And is there a risk that you may not be able to in the timescale the Cabinet Secretary set out?
I think the timescale now is maybe 2026, if I remember rightly. So that depending on the funding we get and when the funding is announced in order to plan for that, then I think 2026 is probably doable. But as I say, it depends on the funding. Before, when we were trying to deliver on that commitment, when it was supposed to come in, was that a couple of years ago, and we hadn't had the funding announced, there was no way we were going to deliver on the commitment because we couldn't plan in advance. So as long as we have the funding confirmed, then we could plan.
Does the panel think that there will be any impact on the capital expenditure to make the infrastructure changes perhaps some of the changes that might need to be made as a result of finding RAC in schools? Will that impact the budget available?
In general terms, in relation to preschool meals, the expansion of preschool meals also requires a capital investment because, if I go back to a few years ago, one of the savings that was taken when I was in my previous local authority was that we reduced the number of production kitchens, and so we centralised production kitchens into particular schools and removed them from it was quite contentious at the time. But as we begin to roll out free school meals and the uptake is bigger again, then we need those production kitchens back, and so that it's that kind of capital investment that's needed. But I mean, just in terms of RAC, if RAC goes on to become an issue, then it's part of the same capital budget. So,
specifically on that later on, if you don't mind. Thank you.
There are,
to your topic, please.
There are, and the detail of that, but delivery of free school meals is dependent on infrastructure. So I'm just keen to understand that if the budget is squeezed from other places, including for RAC, which is not an unreasonable statement, would that risk the delivery of free school meals?
It would be difficult to answer that question. All I would say is that the delivery of free school meals also requires capital investment too. And as Kirsty was saying, we can deliver the policy as long as it's funded, both in terms of capital and revenue costs.
Yeah, thank you.
I think that's the key point. In order to deliver on the Scottish Government commitments, it needs to be fully funded.
Thank you. And the final question I have in this area is, what are the outcomes arising from the expenditure in free school meals that you're seeing across the piece?
Carrie, perhaps you might want to answer this one.
Yes, I suppose the very short-term outcomes are that our children are fed and that they are actually then able to access education. I suppose there are so many attributing factors to attainment outcomes, it would be hard to say that we were seeing that in the actual outcomes for attainment for our young people. But I suppose that's something that over time, it's whether or not you can actually say that there's a cause and effect relationship with that. But certainly we are seeing young people who, you know, may not otherwise be receiving breakfasts particularly. And I think that we've extended quite a lot in a lot of local authorities so that breakfast provision is available in secondary schools as well as in primary. But certainly having that meal or the food that they can access during the day does make them much more ready to learn.
Thank you. Can I follow up on that, Carrie, specifically? So, and how are the educational outcomes of the universal free school meals actually being monitored at a local level? And do you think this type of universal service is something that local government might like the Scottish Government to consider the relative cost effectiveness of the universal provision? Because you've already spoken about the challenges and choices you're making in your budgets.
Yes, so I think the measure at the moment is on inputs and not on outcomes for this particular policy. So I think that, as I've said previously, it's hard to say whether the cause and effect on that of actual attainment outcomes. But certainly the input at the moment is showing that large numbers of our children are receiving food during the day. There are also some families who don't wish to take up free school meals. And I suppose that's the challenge is when you have a universal provision like this, that there will be some families that will not access or that may feel that they don't need to access because they're able to provide for their children themselves. But in terms of outcomes, I'm not aware of at the moment that we're recording in that way. It's more the inputs.
Okay, thanks. Stephanie Callaghan wants to come in on this topic as well.
Thanks.
Before I move to Ross Greer.
Thanks very much, Convener. Oh yeah, I'm switched on. Apologies. Really, really interesting conversation around free school meals, and it does demonstrate really well about it being all about prioritisation, I suppose, because if we have children who are sitting in school and they're hungry, they're not going to be learning at their best, they're not going to be performing at their best level. So I suppose this is all about choices, and certainly there's all the evidence there as well that actually universal free school meals increases the uptake of school meals amongst those children who actually need it most and reduces stigma, etc., there as well. So I'm just wondering, you know, we're talking about further investment, we're talking about the finance behind it, and certainly I appreciate that, yeah, there's capital costs that are there as well, but surely this would be something, for example, that would be a priority for all local authority areas.
Who would like to pick up on that? Is it a priority for all local authority areas, is the question. Carrie, I'm not sure.
Happy to have a stab. I suppose it's the amount of the funding that's required to be able to deliver on a policy such as that, and are the ultimate outcomes that you'll see going forward, are they beneficial to the other policy areas that we're trying to actually address? So I suppose if you think about what PETH's trying to do in the whole attainment challenge, about trying to close the attainment gap, and then we look at the funding that's going to some families who might not be requiring that type of support, trying to put that quite carefully, but I think in a universal programme means that you can't then have your interventions with perhaps the parts of the population that you want to give most to allow them to close that attainment-related, poverty-related attainment gap. I think nobody would ever say that it's not a good thing to have universal food available for our children and young people. I suppose it's the cost and then what the balance is with that, with other policy areas that we may be able to invest in.
Thank you. I'm going to move on now. Ross Greer now, please, if we've got time at the end.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to ask a couple of questions about additional support needs, but just as a precursor to that, because I think it's relevant to just to go back to Michelle Thompson and Ben McPherson's line of question around the Verity House agreement. Could I just clarify with you what you believe from Verity House in terms of flexibilities, removing ring fencing, etc., will be in place for the coming financial year in relation to education? Is your expectation that there will be no ring fenced pots in the coming year? There will be the, I can't remember exactly how they're phrased, but the equivalent agreements between local and national government rather than ring fence pots, and that will take place from 24/5.
I'm not sure if that's what I expect from 24/25. I think the Verity House agreement is moving to that no ring fencing or direction. And I think for 24/25, we're focusing on the in-year transfers. It would be nice if we could have it from 24/25, but I think we're moving in that direction, and I think it might be future years.
If I could just press on that a little bit, because that's really helpful. In that case, what is your expectation for 24/5? Is it just the in-year transfer flexibility that you referenced, or are you expecting some of the currently ring-fenced funds to become flexible to go into the general grant, but not all of them?
Yeah, we need to be careful when we talk about ring fencing, because it's directed funds as well. So the ring fencing, you know, that's a specific grant, and I think it might be like the early learning and childcare specific grant could go into the general pot. For me, I would like to see a relaxation of the payments we have to give our health and social care partnerships, and you know, I think teacher numbers and the absolute nature of that, I think that might be a step too quick for this 24/25, but it remains to be seen. I don't know, I've not been involved in the discussions that COSLA have been having. Maybe if COSLA had been here, they might have been able to give some comment on that.
Let's move on to you.
Thank you. And on additional support needs specifically, I'm interested in the first instance in the guidance that's provided to local authorities to complete your local financial returns, because on ASN it's quite interesting in that some local authorities are able to detail their spend on ASN across primary, secondary, special, and they can break it down and they can disaggregate it. Some local authorities record an ASN spend of zero outside of special schools because they either feel that they can or the guidance isn't clear enough for them, I'm not sure. But whatever it is, their return says ASN spend zero, certainly for primary, secondary. They've clearly integrated it into their wider spend. From your perspective, is the guidance clear enough on what's expected of you in a local financial return, specifically in relation to ASN? If you want to speak more generally about the expectation of local financial return on education spend, that would be helpful as well.
Kirsty again.
Yeah, I apologise. I'm not going to be able to answer that question because I don't fill out the LFR return myself, so I'm not kind of involved in that level of detail, but I can come back to you on that.
That'd be really useful, thank you. Douglas or Carrie, have you got any thoughts on the LFRs?
I'm aware of the LFR and the POBI, but I tend to defer to colleagues who deal with accounts and returns. So I don't know detail on the guidance, but in broad terms, in terms of some struggling to and having theirs at zero, it will be around the complexity of what constitutes a resource for additional support needs. And without going into the detail of staged intervention, you know, the first line is going to be the class teacher. You know, at stage one, class teacher differentiating material and so on. And does that count as an ASN resource when the class teacher is the first person who is going to meet additional support needs? Well, probably not. And so you go along that continuum all the way up to kind of specialist external placement, where it's very easy to determine, but there's a kind of grey area in between what would be normal provision and what would be additional that may make that difficult. But I don't know the guidance on the LFR, so I probably can't answer.
I could ask in somewhat more general terms, because I recognise that was a very specific technical question. How do you, within your local authorities, then, feel confident that you are directing spend as appropriate for children with additional support needs? Because there's a number of points of tension here. In the first instance, the Morgan Review tells us that we need to see all education as ASN education. This needs to be so mainstream. That would then lead you towards a position where it's very, very, very hard to disaggregate that data. But we all recognise that the outcomes for children with additional support needs are not nearly as good as they should be and are not nearly as good as they often are for children without additional support needs. So there's a need for us to be confident that we are putting the right resources into this. So there's obviously a tension here. How do you manage that within your local authorities so that you're confident the resources are going to the individual children who need it, but also that you're directing resources at class and school level towards those where there is a higher prevalence of ASN in general, but of also of specific, more complex needs that require more that require additional resource?
I've been involved in additional support needs for a long time now, and there is a constant tension, because the legal responsibility on us is to meet every need, but the reality is, as we are discussing here today, that there is a limited resource. And so you need to put systems in place to make sure that the allocation of the resource is as fair and equitable as possible. But the 2005 legislation recognised that there was going to be tension, and that's why it put in remedies that didn't exist before, and so there was informal mediation, dispute resolution, and access to tribunal. The reason those remedies were put into the primary legislation, they were there because there was a recognition that it's always going to be that tension between a limited resource versus an almost limitless demand. And so the way we address that is through systems and processes like staged intervention that I was referring to. So at stage one, I would expect, you know, a class teacher identifies there might be issues with a child, they monitor for a while, they put in place resources. Then at stage two, it's flagged up at school level, so they might have an additional support for learning teacher that will do some assessment. Stage three, you're beginning to look external to the school, psychological service. And stage four, you're potentially looking at a specialist placement within the authority or external to the authority. All local authorities will have some form of staged intervention, and it's through staged intervention that we try as best we can to allocate the resource in as fair a way as we can. And in terms of universal allocation, broadly speaking, the scheme of delegation devolved resources to schools would have some kind of formula in it across various authorities. There'll be some kind of formula that takes account of overall population, levels of deprivation and levels of additional support need when allocating resources. So these are the systems and processes, broadly speaking, that will be in place across the country that attempt to address the really difficult challenge of allocating resources as fairly as possible. But I recognise it is hugely contentious. I mean, my inbox, I'm sure some of your inboxes, have been filled with complaints about children and young people not being allocated a specialist place when that's done by a central monitoring group, for example, who look at the broad range and say, these young people, there's space for these young people will be managed within and supported within their local mainstream primary or secondary.
So just on that last point, Douglas, I think there's a really important point there about how we're supporting kids with ASN, either in mainstream or special education. Do you feel that at the moment this is ultimately, in some cases at least, coming down to a question of resource, that there are children who are in mainstream education because of the lack of capacity within special educational settings? Because I recognise that there's two points here. One is where the judgment is made that that child with additional support needs would be better in a mainstream, would thrive more in a mainstream setting. But there's also, certainly from what we get in our inboxes, the implication that local authorities are putting kids with more complex additional needs who would be better off in special educational settings into a mainstream setting due to a lack of resource. Mm.
All of that depends on the context, but broadly speaking, I think local authorities aim to make decisions that are child and young person centred, and we operate in line with the presumption of mainstream that children and young people should be educated in their community, because as soon as you take them out of their community into some specialist facility, they're not known locally, they don't make the connections, they can end up coming out of school and having no connections in the local area. So we operate in line with the presumption of mainstream generally, but the point I would make about local context, I was an inspector for 5 years, HMI, and in that time mainly focused on inspecting specialist provision. It depends on what's available locally. I mean, like, I visited a mainstream primary school in Campbelltown, and in that school they were supporting children who in many other local authorities would be in a specialist facility, but it's Campbelltown, so there isn't a special school, and the travel makes it prohibitive, so they support those children in their local mainstream secondary. So it really depends on the context. Glasgow, we have a large additional support for learning estate, a legacy of the Strathclyde era, probably. So the bigger centres of population may have. So a lot of it depends on your local context.
To Carrie Lindsay, do you want to come in on this? No, you're okay. No. Sorry.
I've got one final point of question for time, can we?
Briefly.
Yeah. It's just about additional support needs, support staff, ASN assistants. The job title varies massively, and that's the point of my questions. A couple of years ago, the government statisticians who compile the school staff census merged the categories of classroom assistant and ASN assistant into pupil support assistant. The predecessor committee in that session had them in to give evidence on that, and what they essentially said was that there's now no longer enough distinction in so many settings between a general classroom assistant and somebody assigned to work specifically with kids with additional support needs, so they weren't able to give us numbers on how many ASN assistants there are.
I know you're...
Does that present a challenge for yourselves as well? Because we literally are unable to count how many support staff are working directly with children with additional needs rather than providing general support to the whole class.
I think that merging of the categories was probably just consistent with practice out there. I mean, I think classroom assistants, if memory serves me, come in at the time of the Macron agreement, and things had moved on from there. And so the vast majority of them were involved in directly supporting children and young people. And in a lot of local authorities, the negotiations took place so that they all went on to a single contract because they were paid the same anyway. Mm. So I think the classroom assistant is a historical legacy from the Macron agreement, and my presumption, I may be wrong, my presumption would be the vast majority are involved in supporting children and young people with additional support needs.
Thanks.
Thank you, Ross. Can I now move to my vice convener, Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. I have a couple of questions about children's services. The first is around the promise, and I'd be interested to hear panel members' reflections on the practicalities of delivering the local government elements of the promise in the current financial context. Just while you're thinking, I suppose that one of the issues that's live for us as a committee at the moment is the Care and Justice Scotland Bill, which obviously has implications for local government as well. So maybe you can speak to that a little.
Who'd like to go first? Carrie?
I'm happy to go first. Give Douglas a wee bit of thinking time since he's been speaking there. I think that the promise, I think everybody accepts that it's a really useful tool for us to change the way that we work within local authorities with our most vulnerable young people. I think that there was an expectation at the outset that there would be no funding or very little funding. There is some funding for particular projects, but there wasn't money that came through, and this would normally be through COSLA, that came to local authorities. And I think for me that was the right and the wrong decision, if I can put it that way, because I think that there is an expectation that you look at all of your processes in your systems, and you don't always need money to do that. So enable to be able to actually deliver on some of the asks, so particularly within education, there is some funding through the, I can't remember exactly what it's called, but the PEF fund that supports our care experienced young people. So there is funding there that supports some of the implementation, I would say, of the promise and the expectations for education. And I think that across children's services, people have been working really hard at a children's services partnership level to try to make sure that they are identifying where they need to pull funds together to be able to deliver on that. But I do think that if there had been some funding that went to all children's services partnerships to be able to support the delivery of the actions within the promise, I think that would have been beneficial.
Dr. Hutchison?
No, I would really just echo what Carrie said. We're all absolutely committed to the promise, and we all recognise there's significant scope to improve outcomes for care-experienced children and young people. And the care-experienced pupil equity, I don't think it's called that, care-experienced PEF funding, is certainly making a difference and helping them. And I know that in Glasgow we have the Glasgow Virtual School team who are working intensively to support better outcomes for children and young people who are care experienced. So we are absolutely committed to it and we'll find ways to deliver it regardless, I would say.
Okay, thank you. There is a reduction in real terms for the expected net spend on children and families' social work services in 23-24 when compared to 2019-20 net spend. Can you speak to what that reduction might look like in practice for children and families' services and for children and family that use children and their families that use those services?
I'll maybe go for that. I was a director until I retired recently of education and children's services, so I had children and families responsibility. So I'm just going to say from that perspective, not in my ADES role. But I think that, what we've seen is that our young people want to stay in their communities the same way as we've talked about ESN young people, that we want them to be in their communities. And certainly what we saw in Fife was that our young people, when they reached age 16, if they'd been away from home somewhere, they returned home. So many authorities, and Fife included, took the decision to be thinking about how can we actually support them to stay at home rather than removing them to another place where it might have been seen at that point that it was the best thing to do. So we have seen significant reductions in the high cost placements for residential care, and I think that's where you'll see that across Scotland, that people have tried really hard, and I think that the promise has helped with a lot of that, to try to keep brothers and sisters together, to try to make sure that we've got families that are supported in their homes. So there has been a shift in the way that children and families have worked in a lot of local authorities, so that they are now supporting in a much more preventative way, or there is family support going in as well as perhaps some of the more statutory social work support. But I think the reduction in cost, I would hope, certainly what I saw in Fife, was that it was really the reduction in the high cost placements. It wasn't a reduction in what we were able to offer families. In fact, quite the reverse, we were able to use the money much more effectively to support the families and keep families together, which was of benefit to the children and young people.
That's interesting, thank you. Kirsty, do you have any comments on that?
Nothing to add.
Okay.
Thank you, Convener. Do you want to come in on that, Dr. Hutchison? Are you
no, okay? I was really just going to say that, education and children and family social work work very closely together. So any challenges for either us or for them has implications for both of us. But the whole Family Wellbeing Fund at the moment is a great opportunity because it is focused on transformational change. Carrie was mentioning, you know, bringing young people back from external expensive external placements, for example. I mean, Glasgow, I think, has been particularly successful in that. That kind of transformational change where you get young people back in their own community with the right support is an opportunity that's provided by the whole Family Wellbeing Fund at this point in time, I would say.
Okay, that's great, helpful. Thank you. And can I come to Liam Kerr now? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I would like to investigate some areas around capital expenditure. And specifically, I wonder, do you have a view, do any of you have a view on the design of the Scottish Government's Learning Estate Investment Programme? And particularly, given that presumably the local authorities pay the upfront costs of that.
Kirsty.
Yeah, there is a risk that local authorities have to take with the current programme that we would have to borrow or fund up front, and we would only get the funding if we met a number of criteria. There are a number of them. I don't know all the detail, energy and things like that. So there is a risk there. I'd like to think the risk was low if we're trying to deliver a better estate, which is what the programme is all about. It's disappointing that we haven't had the announcement of the third year learning estate investment programme. I think we were expecting that before Christmas, and it's been delayed and delayed. So.
Thank you for that answer, and I was specifically looking to follow up on that exact point, Kirsty Flanagan, because yes, as I understand it, the third funding was meant to be allocated last year and hasn't been. So what impact would that have on any capital investment programme, and specifically and bluntly, will this affect the building of new schools?
It may well, because we would have to look. I mean, last year when we did the business case for the one that we applied for, you know, it was done in September last year. Costs have moved on since then. And so, you know, I think even if an announcement was made, I think local authorities will have to assess whether in the current financial climate that they're still able to deliver and what they hope to deliver on last September.
Thank you. And final question for me, staying in this area, Kirsty Flanagan, if I may. Into this context, as we heard from Pam Duncan-Glancy earlier, we have the RAC situation. Do you have any concerns that addressing RAC may have a detrimental impact on the future LEAP funding?
I am hearing that the RAC situation, you know, that could be one source of funding. Would it have a detrimental impact? I guess if there is RAC issues to deal with in the current school estate, we need to deal with them as well, because the safety of the children is of importance. It could be the detriment of building new school estate that is probably much needed.
Actually, just if I may, then how are local authorities preparing to deal with the RAC situation and to fund any necessary work? Do you know?
COSLA could probably have given you a better answer to that, because I've not been involved, because it's more my property colleagues that have been involved in, and certainly in Argyll and Bute, we only have one school that has elements of RAC, and it's just small elements of RAC. So. And we were aware of that, and we're dealing with it as part of routine maintenance and putting mitigation measures in place. But I know that some authorities are affected by it, by a number of their establishments, and therefore I think the challenge for them financially will be huge. But I couldn't provide any more comment than that. I don't know if other colleagues have information.
Does anyone else want to come in on that subject? No.
I'm very grateful for your answers, Convener.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I'd like to thank the panel for their time today. And we will now have a suspension to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much.
Our second item on our agenda today is an evidence session on the report of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment. Can I welcome Professor Louise Hayward, Professor of Education, Assessment and Innovation, University of Glasgow, and Chair of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment. Professor Ken Muir, Honorary Professor at the University of the West of Scotland and member of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment Group. And Peter Bain, head teacher from Oban High School and member of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment Group. So thank you all for joining us today. And we will begin with a short opening statement from Professor Hayward. Professor, you have up to 3 minutes, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, and thank you to the committee for taking the time to discuss the independent review with us, and also for having taken the time to read it. We're really grateful to you for the investment of your time in that process. I think there are five key issues that we would like to draw to your attention in particular. The first is that the report offers a longer-term direction of travel for qualifications and assessment in Scotland. This isn't a quick fix. This is about thinking about the future and making sure that we have a future that serves every learner well, and also Scotland as a nation well. Secondly, although I keep seeing this in the press, this is not the Hayward report. Nothing could be further from the truth. This is a report that has engaged communities across the country who've been actively engaged in working through ideas. So what you have in front of you is the thinking, the agreed position across all of these different communities, and I think that's a really important issue. I think that the third point that we'd like to make is that the vision is absolutely crucial. It's really important that we have a very clear idea about what it is that we're trying to achieve, and then everything we do should be directed towards that. And the vision isn't only important at the beginning of the process. We have experience in Scotland, but there's also evidence that this happens internationally, that often innovation begins with good ideas. But over time, what happens is that the developments in practice begin to differ from the vision. And if that isn't picked up quickly enough, then you get to a point where a number of years down the line, you have to go through the whole process again. So the vision is the touchstone. And that over time, as ideas develop in practice, then it's really important that we go back to that vision and we gather evidence of what's happening in practice to make sure that we stay consistent with these key ideas. And that leads us into point four. What we have learned from the curriculum in Scotland, but also internationally, is that it isn't enough to plan for the educational aspect of innovation. There also has to be a plan for change. And so the process of change has got to be carefully planned, and to be effective, it has to be co-constructed. So everyone involved in making it work, they all have to be involved in the process. And that the pace of putting ideas into practice should depend on the level of resourcing available. So it's working through the ideas and being realistic about the investment that can be made as they develop. And then the fifth point we'd like to make is that there is no idea that's contained within this report that is not already in practice in at least one country. Indeed, many of the ideas are already in practice in some schools and colleges in Scotland. So the report, It's Our Future, is both principled and practical. And it's about seeking to make high quality provision available for every learner.
Okay, thank you.
The colleagues that I have with me have been chosen very carefully.
No pressure.
That you know, Ken Muir is originally a geography teacher, but has had a range of roles across the education system and is now working internationally. Peter Bain is a highly respected head teacher who's worked in a range of areas in Scotland, across Scotland, in leadership roles, and also has leadership positions within Scottish Leaders Scotland and also within Bosch. So policy, research, practice, we hope that we've got a range of perspectives and we're looking forward to engaging with you in discussion.
Thank you. So this should be an exciting session then with all this experience in front of us. So I'd thank you very much for that opening statement and for also submitting the paper that we have that was formed around those 5 points. Can I ask the first question before I move on to questions elsewhere? We know and we've heard a lot about that common approach that's taken in Scotland of 2 or 3 years each with externally marked exams and how that is quite rare. So what evidence have you had that that approach needs to change?
I'll start and then I'll maybe pass to Peter in response to that. I think there has been consistent evidence across a whole range of reports that there are real challenges within this idea of 3 consecutive years of examinations. We heard consistently from young people and from teachers deep frustration about the balance of time spent in assessment and examination processes as opposed to focusing and deepening learning and teaching. Professor Stobart in his report indicated that Scotland is almost unique in having 3 points of high stake assessments, one after the other. And the evidence that we had from learners was that much of their experience in the senior phase is focused on preparing for examinations. So they have practice tests, they have past papers, they have prelims. In some schools, there were 3 prelims over the course of every year. And if you think about the amount of time, therefore, that's spent in rehearsal for the high-stakes exam, then that led to disillusionment with the young people and frustration from teachers in the way in which the senior phase was developing.
I suppose, are you saying that there's a real disconnect between what they're doing, the young people are doing in their senior phase and the curriculum for excellence and that focus? It's taken me back, shivers down my spine, remembering all of those things when I was in school. So,
Peter, you may want to comment on that.
Thank you, Professor Hoover. Thanks very much, convener. Before I begin, if you don't mind, I'd like to say that these are just not my personal views and that what I'm about to tell you has come from a very large number of senior leaders in schools across the country. I chaired a community collaborative of school leaders on behalf of the IRG. There were 11 members. They were chosen deliberately to gain access to the independent sector, to Catholic schools, to Gaelic schools. They covered everywhere from the Highlands and Islands and down to the borders and everything in between. Each of the members were tasked with creating their own collaborative of roughly another 10 headteachers from a variety of schools, taken from those wide range of communities and from, of course, their own local authorities. So that 11, including me, 12, could be multiplied by 10 at the minimum. Each were also tasked with discussing this with their deputies, their senior leadership teams, their principal teachers, and, of course, their own school communities. So what I'm about to tell you comes from across the country and not just from me. This particular issue, convener, was one of the most vocally put forward as a failing of the current system. You would be hard-pressed to find a school leader, in my opinion, who does not think that a curriculum for excellence is a wonderful ideology, one to be aspired to. And when it was introduced through a series of documents published by Education Scotland called Building the Curriculum, it was welcomed because of the support it got. Building the Curriculum 3 set the vision. Then Building the Curriculum 4 sought to build on that by promoting skills and experiences that would give breadth and relevance to the learning that we were providing in our schools. But shortly after that, Building the Curriculum 5 was published, and Building the Curriculum 5 was about assessment models. And very quickly, schools were diverted away from development of skills and experiences that would better prepare youngsters for life after school, life straight into the workplace, or the workplace after further education or higher education. And it concentrated on exams. And the consequence of that pattern of behaviour, that continued pattern of behaviour, is that we continued to seek to produce statistics that show their schools and their local authorities and indeed the country in a good light, comparing 5+ higher in particular, but not exclusively, year on year. The trouble with doing that is that we continue to teach the same narrow-based subjects to try and secure our continuing pass rate so we don't fall down whatever artificial league table we produce. That, unfortunately, has a perverse impact on our curriculums in many schools, not all, many, in that by narrowing the curriculum to try and hit the 5+, we are not offering the correct pathway or the desired pathway of many youngsters who may find it more beneficial to do national progression awards or to do skills for work or merely to drop a couple of subjects because we are able to now do what's called flexible learning plans and have them with employers, getting them ready for the workplace. And because of that, our head teachers, our school leaders, not just head teachers, our school leaders are frustrated by that continual focus on an exam-only system. And they feel that that's perpetuated down the years, to get right into the point that you ask, convener, which is if we are focusing on trying to get as many exam passes as possible rather than the acquisition of knowledge, skills and experiences, then to achieve that goal, we do exams, we do prelims, schools do practice prelims. In fact, many schools do two prelims because they'll do a prelim in November and then they'll do another one in March because the SQA are requiring a degree of robust evidence that can't be achieved in November because we're only two-thirds of the way through a course or even one-third in some courses. The whole system is designed to pass exams and not to prepare our youngsters for life after school. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Professor Muir, do you want to come in on that as well?
Thanks, Convener. I think, as many of you know, I authored the report Putting Learners at the Centre, which was published just over a year ago. And one of the things that I did was undertake a very extensive survey of practitioners, but also children and young people. And there were a number of messages, I think, that came back that gave significant evidence that aligns with what Louise found out in leading her review of assessment and qualifications. So concerns about the two-term dash to higher, that's been something that's been very consistent in Scottish education. The three-year back-to-back examinations, as Peter suggested, you know, even more of that. The lack of articulation between broad general education and the aspirations of curriculum for excellence and the assessment and qualification system that we've got. What are perceived by many as a very heavy knowledge and understanding, content-laden curriculum with the kinds of skills and competencies that are deemed to be appropriate for current and future learners, largely missing from the curriculum, a compression of time. All of these things came through very significantly in my report, and again, working with Louise and her team, that came through very significantly for them as well. I say in my report we've got a very examination-dominated system in Scotland, and I was quite concerned, speaking to primary head teachers, that they were making the point that the curriculum in primary schools now is being directed by what is required in secondary, which is largely driven by what the exams require. And I make the point that the kind of metrics that we talk about in Scottish education as being a measure of quality, i.e. the number of hires that a young person might achieve in a single sitting in S5, is not the kind of metric that is appropriate for the future. And that we've narrowed, as Louise was suggesting, you know, we've had a narrowing of the curriculum, largely because the main thrust for quality assurance purposes is how well young people do in examinations and how well they do in standardised assessments. And we know that young people and children, even in primary, achieve much more than simply passes in examinations. So I think one of the things that we're trying to do in this report is to look at how we change some of the mindset and some of the culture around Scottish education, in particular the assessment and examination requirements.
Thank you very much. I've got a brief supplementary from myself before I come to Willie Rennie on this. And it's directly to you, Peter. If there is the flexibility that you've spoken about that's in this to do a range of things, where does the pressure then lie to continue the way we've always done it?
The pressure largely lies in the way in which we report on our success. There is a societal pressure to publish, not helped by national newspapers, to publish league tables. Now, obviously, the Scottish Government do not publish themselves, but reporters formulate it. That impacts on parents' views on the success of the school or otherwise, which then impacts on elected members, which impacts on directors of education and down into head teachers in schools, etc. So that publication of the artificial league table doesn't help. That's where a lot of the pressure comes from. However, I would argue that there are many head teachers and many local authorities who have woken up in the last 5, 6, 7 years to this threat and are prepared to tell the full story about the success of individual schools, and that it's not just about passing 5 highers or 5 national 5s. They are prepared to stand up and illustrate the positive destinations that are achieved by their youngsters. If you're in a school that's got a high level of employment opportunity in your area, you will find that youngsters will leave school directly and go into the workplace, and that's to be applauded. But by doing so, it reduces the percentage of those who are able to clock up 5+. But the success is there. We've provided an education system full of experiences and skills development and knowledge acquisition that's getting them into a lot more apprenticeships these days and getting them into the world they work, rather than keeping them on at school trying to clock up qualifications that will just get them into the workplace later. And that's not to say, and I don't mind if you don't mind, that's not to say that we're harming those who wish to go to university, because the statistics will show us, and we can see this in a programme called Insight that schools use for self-evaluation, we can see quite often that percentage of those who are going on to university still secure the percentage pass rates and in fact go on and get 7, 8, 9 hires if that's the journey that they wish to take.
Peter, can I come to supplementary from Willie Rennie now, please?
Thanks, Mr. Bean, for the clarity with which you're speaking this morning. I think it's really helpful. You mentioned Insight. Is Insight part of the problem? Are we measuring the right things with Insight?
Thanks, Mr. Rennie. I think that Insight, I personally, so I'm not speaking for the other people I mentioned earlier, I personally think that Insight is a very valuable tool. It allows us to deep dive, to use a schooly phrase, but get to the nub of how are our additional support needs pupils doing? I've got a hostel, school accommodation service. How are they getting on? It really allows us to go in depth and to work out what is it that we need to support to allow them to achieve the qualifications that they wish or they need. So I think it's a valuable tool. It does have one part in it, which is called breadth and depth. And unfortunately, that is the one part of Insight that everybody hones into, and many do not use it to its full capacity to deliver the best choices for our youngsters. But it's a good tool. One bit's used very badly, in my personal view.
Thank you. Thank you. Bill Kidd, can we come to you now, please?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. Hi, panel. Can I ask how well understood and trusted is the current suite of qualifications that are taken in Scotland schools? I mean, are they, do people really understand them and trust them in depth?
Over to Peter again.
Thank you, Mr. Cook. I am sure, but not positive, that our school leaders across the country and the teachers within them are very aware of the suite of opportunities that are available now and how they link to the Scottish Credit and Qualification Framework, which all schools are now using extensively, and it's heavily promoted by Skills Development Scotland, as well as the schools and local authorities themselves. That's helped for our education communities to understand a parity of esteem. Gradually, over the last few years, our parent bodies, through the work done online and with additional meetings by CQF framework personnel and SDS and schools, are becoming more aware of the value of National Progression Awards, Skills for Works, baccalaureates, foundation apprenticeships in particular have seen a large rise in uptake because of their value. And that is a slow, steady and very positive progress. However, you would be right to say that not everybody fully gets it. But mind you, I've still got parents that think we still do O-levels, and we never did O-levels in the first place.
Okay. Oh, sorry, Professor Hayward.
Just to support what Peter's saying, that the difficulty with asking a question like that is that there are so many different answers, and it depends who the individual is and who the area would be. One of the issues that was interesting during the review was that employers talking about the limited use that they make of the evidence coming from qualifications. So, you know, 6 months into the workplace and nobody will ever ask you again what qualifications you had. And similarly, universities use the qualifications as a means of deciding who will get entry to which particular course. But if we're serious as a society about ideas of lifelong learning, then we need to think about a system that actually, it's not like falling off a cliff when you leave school or college, but actually it transitions with you into the next stage, and then you can build and you can grow from that. And the evidence that we have around the speed of change in society suggests that learners are going to have to be flexible learners all of their lives, because of the speed at which things are changing. So we need a system that supports all of our learners through these processes, and that the what they have achieved in school or college then goes with them into the next stage of their life, and they continue to build from that. So, and the other issue I think that your question really interestingly raises is that perhaps as an education system we have in the past paid insufficient attention to a communication strategy. And that any innovation has also to have a very clear communication strategy, and not simply one that's linked to the point where the innovation is introduced, but one that recognises that that communication strategy has to develop over time and be sustained, so that we build up the changes in understanding across society over time.
Very helpful. Professor Muir.
Yeah, Mr. Kidd, I think you raise an interesting point about trust and confidence in the education system. And when I compare the trust and confidence in the assessment and qualification system that we have in Scotland with what I see, particularly in Nordic countries, it's transformationally different. I think we have a very high trust system in those countries, and perhaps less so in Scotland, and yet we have experts on the ground, practitioners in our schools, who are well trained, who are ready to operate as experts in the system, and we make very little use of that expertise within the qualifications and examination system, much less so than in many other countries in the world. And of course that was one of the reasons why we suffered the problems that we did with the 2 years of COVID and the examination system having to operate very, very differently. When I look at what happens in the Nordic countries, they did not suffer anything like the same fragmentation and the same problems that we have faced in Scotland. So I think that in itself demonstrates that building trust and confidence, which is similar to what we see in some other countries, is part of the culture shift, I think, that we need to make within the Scottish system. But it also demonstrates that there are systems in the world where teacher expertise, teacher professional judgment and so on is used to a far greater extent than it is in Scotland just now.
Thank you very much. That actually helps potentially. I'm just going to read this out because I think it's important. It's on the record, actually, that the review came out with a vision. And the vision is that an inclusive and highly regarded qualifications and assessment system that inspires learning, values the diverse achievements of every learner in Scotland and supports all learners into the next phase of their lives, socially, culturally and economically, which I think is a brilliant vision. To what degree then, going back to what we were talking about earlier, to what degree was the current suite of qualifications used to support this vision going forward, set out in the review? How was it used to actually sort of shape the vision, the current qualification system?
The current qualification system, I think, would be part of would serve aspects of the vision, but I think we were very clear as an independent review group that the current system does not serve all of the aspects of the vision. And so therefore, we had to consider, you know that there were three phases of the consultation. The first phase was agreeing the vision across all of the communities that we described, getting to a point where we say, okay, this is the direction of travel that we would like for Scottish education, Scottish society. And then the second phase of the vision was around, so what are the parameters? What might that begin to look like in practice? And then we consulted in that. And then the third phase was from the feedback that we got, we then developed a model to say, okay, this is what this is going to, this is what this might look like. And then we consulted on that. But I think our starting point was very clearly that our current system does not meet aspects, all aspects of that vision.
Okay, well,
Mr. Cuddon, I'd like to come in there. You mentioned the suite. I think it would be remiss not to separate the system from the suite of qualifications. There is, in our view, the collective view of those that were involved in, certainly my work, there was a clear view that the system is failing our youngsters. The suite of qualifications is not challenged. There is a wonderful array of qualifications delivered by educationalists across the country, whether that be in schools or further education, that serve the needs of our youngsters. The Scottish Qualification Authority at the current time oversees around a couple of hundred. The number varies, but there's around a couple of hundred courses that they oversee. And they're only one qualification body that we use to tease out a wealth of qualifications that are best suited for our youngsters, particularly going into vocational and professional environments. What was criticised in relation to the suite, however, which is why the interdisciplinary learning part of the Scottish Diploma of Achievement came to be, is that as much as we have all these professionals providing discrete educational experiences and knowledge, they weren't tying up. And in real life, we don't just talk history. We talk history when we're discussing economics, or we talk history in terms of our family tree, or we talk geography in the terms of geopolitics, or where do we want to go on our holidays. There is the main criticism with the suite is not its breadth, it's the fact that we don't talk to each other. And so I would hope that the new qualifications awarding body would seek to develop interdisciplinary understanding and courses that would better allow our youngsters to see the relevance of all these important topics. And if they see more relevance and they see why it can be used going forward, they might buy into them an even greater number and pass their assessments, not necessarily the exams, but pass the assessments as they go forward.
That was the end, Professor.
Just to add to that, Mr. Kidd, I think it's really important to remember that this is not just about qualifications. This is about achievements. And young people and children from early years all the way through primary and into secondary make achievements in their learning that currently, with the metrics that we use in the system, which are largely about performance and standard nationalised assessments and examinations, those achievements, which in some cases are very significant, particularly for children who are presenting with an additional support need or a learning disability, currently we do not openly recognise and value those in the way that we value qualifications. And part of the vision is trying to recognise and find a mechanism for recognising those wider achievements that young people make, which is one of the reasons why the personal pathway is an important element of the diploma that's been proposed.
So hence, in the vision, that's supporting all learners into the next phase of their lives, socially, culturally and economically.
Absolutely. It's not just very much so.
Aye.
It's not just about examinations and qualifications.
Right. There's also one important thing in the vision, which is inspiring learning.
Yeah.
And the kinds of opportunities. Young people commonly talk to us about the fact that they want to make a difference to the world. They want opportunities to use the knowledge that they're developing in the subject areas. They recognise that the subject knowledge is important, but they want to be able to think about how they can use that knowledge in order to improve society. And so this would give them an opportunity actually to do that. And what's really interesting is that these are exactly the kinds of qualities. Often we talk about knowledge and skills as if they're separate. You know, you can't develop skills without knowledge, and there's no point in having knowledge unless you can think about how you use it. So in that kind of context, then these are the kinds of things that employers were suggesting were absolutely crucial for the future of each young person. And also the universities were arguing that it's the combination of knowledge and skills that actually is really important, and that both in the workplace and in colleges and universities, many of the approaches that we are proposing within the Scottish Diploma of Achievement are already in place. So what we're looking to do is to develop approaches to learning and achievement and progression that will actually better support learners into the next phase of their lives.
Sounds quite inspiring. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that scene setting. Can I move to some questions now from Liam Kerr, please?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just a couple of quick questions at this stage on the process of the review group. So, Professor Hayward, the review was based on what was called an integrity model of change. Can you tell the committee how does the work that you undertook and the final report reflect that integrity model, please?
Okay. The integrity model of change, as somebody who spent her entire life trying to demystify and remove jargon from assessment, it does sound awfully jargony. But actually, it's very simple. It was an empirical model that was developed from work originally in Scotland around a programme called Assessment is for Learning. And Assessment is for Learning was described by the then Education Minister as a quiet revolution in Scottish education. I.e. it made differences in what teachers were doing in classrooms that other previous innovations had not had that kind of level of impact. And school inspectors were going into schools saying that they didn't come across a teacher or a school who hadn't heard about this. And that's quite unusual for that kind of innovation. So as part of that, at the end of it, we interviewed, as a piece of research, we interviewed learners and teachers and local and national policymakers and all of the people who were involved in the process. And when we analysed the evidence, three things mattered. The first thing was educational integrity. So people had to have a clear vision. You need to be clear about what you're doing. And you also have to be clear that it's going to make a positive difference to children's learning or to young people's learning. So that's the educational integrity bit. And so within the review, we then began from working with the Scottish Youth Parliament and the Children's Parliament towards developing a vision, which we would believe is in line with UNCRC. So that was the first bit, and that's how that bit. The second bit is called personal and professional integrity. And that means that all of the people who have a role to play in making the innovation work have to be involved from the beginning in its development. So they think through the issues as they develop. And so the model that we developed, which was the matrix model, where we had those for whom qualifications matter most, that's learners and as appropriate parents or carers, and then the second group of people, those who are involved in the design, the development, and those who offer qualifications, and then the third set of communities, those who use qualifications. And all of these people matter if qualifications are going to be effective and credible in the system. And then on the other side of the matrix, to make sure that the programme was as well informed as it possibly could, we had a number of research communities where we brought together national and international experts in different fields. So in curriculum, in assessment qualifications, in process of change, in equity, and in policy alignment. So that was the personal and professional integrity bit. And then the systemic integrity, you'll see reflected, I hope, in the recommendations, that innovation is a little like the back. If you take the back from an old-fashioned watch and you see all these little cogs turning, so if any one of these cogs stops, then the watch doesn't work. So you need, for example, initial teacher education to be involved in, as people are coming into the profession from the beginning, these are the expectations that they'll have. You need school inspectors when they go into schools to be looking for the evidence of the Scottish Diploma of Achievement. So all of these bits together, you need to make sure that the data being gathered reflects the key ideas in the Scottish Diploma of Achievement. And so that's the systemic integrity bit. So that was the model on which the whole development was based.
I understand. Thank you for that, and thank you for the detail. Specifically on the second part of that, the personal and professional integrity, and I think you talked about the second part of that matrix. The Cabinet Secretary has said that before taking forward any reform in the qualifications, she needs to hear from teachers specifically, particularly secondary teachers, who she says will be key in driving forward any changes. So, preempting that then, how did your review ensure that it's heard from those teachers? What did that group broadly tell you? And how did those discussions impact on the final output?
Okay. It's a really interesting question. Because in addition to all of the independent review group with all of the communities and the community collaborative groups that you've heard about, we also set up a process whereby for each of the three phases of the consultation, we developed packages of materials that were sent out to every school and college in the country. What we learned through that process was, I think that we assumed that it would therefore get to every teacher in the country. What we discovered was that although that was a really good approach in theory, in practice it was patchy. So it got blocked at different points in the system. And I'll ask Peter in a second to talk about examples of where it worked, or indeed Ken, to talk about examples of where it worked very well. But we became conscious of the fact that via social media in particular, I was getting feedback from teachers saying, nobody's asked me. And then you start to realise that actually it was getting through into some areas, but in other areas it didn't seem to be working terribly effectively. And so I think there's learning to be done. So I think the Cabinet Secretary's position where she is saying, I really would like to hear from every teacher in the country, is a really important part of the process. And it is important to have these conversations because everyone should be involved in this process. I think that from the model that we developed, then there's learning to be done about how these systems work in practice. Because I think as a group, we would argue that actually, if we're talking about changing culture, then we need ways of engaging at scale with key people within the education system. And so I think there's learning to be done from the approach that we undertook. But I think that the model and the means of involving people in this process, for the innovation to be successful, we need to continue that process. This is cultural change. This is about... can I say that not all of the meetings of the independent review group were uncontentious? You know, we had really interesting and sometimes quite heated debates about issues. But our position was either you work these issues through as the programme's developing, or you're going to have to pick up the problems later. So it's a process by which you deal both in a principled way, but also in an essentially practical way with the future. And I think we would argue that for cultural change to be developed, then these processes have to continue where everyone has a voice and everyone's voice is part of coming through to agreed positions.
Is Peter wanting to come in? The Professor Hayward was suggesting you may want to.
I was just checking to see if Professor Muir wanted to come in before I started speaking again. But thank you, Convener. Yeah, some of these discussions we had in these meetings for just over a year were interesting indeed. But I'm glad to say, do you know, right at the beginning, Professor Hayward says it's not the Hayward Review. And at each stage and after each of these meetings that we had over just over a year, after every meeting, there was the question presented by Lees that basically said, do we agree? Are we content to move forward as a collective position? You know, and the universities were there and the trade unions were there, school leaders were there, the youngsters were there, etc. So that was always measured as we went. I think that that example of experience of when we all gathered together and we talked about each stage in that journey, we came to a consensus through communication and the acquisition of understanding. And I think herein lies the problem that Mr. Kerr has alluded to, that all these teachers are saying, I don't know anything about this and I'm not sure about this and I don't like it, etc. I have to say, in the year that I spent doing that and subsequently since, because I do get the opportunity to go and speak to other local authorities and other schools and other groups on the subject just because I was in these discussions, when I hold a session, even if it's just a couple of hours, with a group of school leaders or a group of teachers or whoever, when you talk it through and they understand the background to some of the recommendations, they go, aye, I'll sign up for that. Yeah, I'll agree to that. I did the one just last week for School Leaders Scotland, where all the local authorities were represented. And the first question, and it's on the PowerPoint that got issued to all schools as well, you know, do you support the Scottish Diploma of Achievement in principle? And everyone bar two said yes, because we had had a discussion and they understood it. If you just go to a teacher cold, they're going to go, no, because they fear naturally and justifiably about workload in particular. This is something new. Anybody, doesn't matter what your occupation is, if you suggest something new, they're always going to say, I'm already too busy. But if you talk through what is it that we could give up, or what is it that we could change, or what is it that we could adapt to create the time to make the system, the opportunities better, then they go, aye, as long as I get time, as long as I get some money, as long as I get some resources, I'll sign up for that. And I think that's where we are just now. So we did I mentioned, you know, the 11 head teachers, their groups of 10, all their school communities. See, if you go to these schools, they're okay with it. The SDA, the Scottish Diploma of Achievement. They wish to accept it in principle, but they still want to know the devil in the detail. They want to move into a planning for implementation stage, but they accept it in principle. The teachers or the schools who did not engage and do not understand it, they're the ones who are more vocally saying, hold on a minute. And so because there's a fair few of them, it's quite natural that the Cabinet Secretary has taken poison. You know, measure twice, cut once. No harm will be done. They'll come to the agreement that everybody else does once they understand it, that this is a good idea that needs teased out.
Thank you.
Grateful.
Thank you. Ben McPherson has a short supplementary on this.
It's just my main question, if that's okay, Convener, because it's related to this point. Thanks, panel. Think back to I was in the first year of or second year of Higher Still and the implementation of NABs and that initial culture change, and then the position of coursework and continuous assessment altered in the years ahead. And I think that speaks to your point at the beginning, Professor, about the need for continually emphasising the vision through the practical implementation. So thinking ahead to the process of implementing the SDA and the points that Peter Baines just made, how important, following on from that consultation with teachers in the short term, but as we enter the implementation phase and considerations around workload and buy-in, teacher training and continuous professional development seem to me to be really crucial in making this work, and I just wondered if you had any reflections on that.
Yes.
Band on that.
I love it. I suppose because I was using one word there because I can't emphasise that strongly enough. That
we like concise answers. We like positive, strong answers.
Yeah, it was that the countries who where they make greatest progress in terms of supporting learners' achievements are those who invest in their teachers. And it is really important to invest in the professionalism of teachers in Scotland. And one of the interesting things I think that we found in the review is how many creative and frustrated teachers there are in Scotland. Who care, all teachers care deeply about the learners with whom they work. And many of them were expressed frustration about the fact that, they believe that the current system in the senior phase drives them into fairly predictable behaviours where they're involved in a lot of rehearsal with learners. Rather than having excite them about learning, having passion about what they're doing. And it's interesting that in the schools we've been in where, Ken may have some really good examples of this, but the schools that we've been in, where they've been involved in the project learning approach, the level of enthusiasm from learners and also the level of enthusiasm from teachers is incredible. But people have to be supported through that. And so the system also has to recognise that if this is the way forwards, then at the beginning in initial teacher education, teachers will be introduced to these ideas as what it is to be a teacher. So they will expect to work in subject areas, but they will also expect to work across subject areas. They will expect to be involved in project learning. They will expect to be involved in conversations with learners about their personal pathway. And through that process, you build capacity. And for teachers who are already in post, then we use the term teacher as if there is a single teacher. The truth is that we have teachers in very different circumstances at very different stages in their own thinking. And so I think that we need to be supportive of people. We start from where they are and we support them through into this process. But I couldn't agree with you more strongly that these things are really important.
And if I may, Convener, just given the changes that were made in that first period of the implementation of Higher Still, so the alterations that were made in terms of assessment, will it be important, learning from that process, to have a consistent and stable position for a good period in order to properly embed the implementation of Curriculum for Excellence in this next important phase?
Without doubt.
Okay.
Absolutely without doubt.
Thank you, Professor Muir. I'll let you respond as well.
I think your questions relate back to what Mr. Kerr was talking about, and I think we genuinely need to learn as a system some of the lessons from the implementation or the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence. I think it's questionable how successful we were in doing that, and professional learning and engagement of all staff in the philosophy around any reform or change is absolutely critical. And that's where I think Cabinet Secretary's survey might be quite helpful, particularly to touch on those schools to begin to think about what this reform could look like, so that they are at least at the starting blocks, if you like, in thinking about the reform. More specifically, in relation to some of the things that are happening out there, as Peter said earlier, you know, there are a lot of elements within the diploma that are already happening out there, and particularly the project learning, which, you know, we see as very much an interdisciplinary approach to learning and to providing young people with problem-solving challenges, so that they're bringing their knowledge and experience from a range of subjects and disciplines. You know, if you take, for example, what's happening just now, Ms. Thompson, in your constituency with Fuel Change, the Falkirk-based organisation that is offering an SCQF Level 6 qualification over this year. They've got over 600 students across, I think, 21 local authorities in Scotland undertaking the kind of project learning that we are anticipating as part of the Scottish Diploma of Achievement. And you've also got organisations like the Vardy Foundation, who are offering a Gen Plus experience to students in, I think, about 6 local authorities now, that are allowing them to develop some of the skills and what are generally referred to as the kind of meta skills, so things like building resilience, leadership, cooperation and collaboration, problem-solving activities of the kind that all of the international research shows is the kind of experiences from education that current and future generations of young people are going to need if they're going to deal with the kind of challenges that they will face, not just in school, but throughout their lives. So there are a good number of things happening there, but I think learning some of the lessons where we didn't get it quite right in introducing Curriculum for Excellence, sharing the philosophy, developing the understanding, and critically ensuring that teacher education programmes in Scotland and that the CPD, the continuous professional development that teachers require, is provided there upfront as part of the reform process.
Thank you. I am doing my convener role here and I've got my eye on the clock. We're getting some really great responses from the panel, but I am going to have to ask you to try and curtail and keep them as concise as possible. We've still got an awful lot of questions to go through, and I'm really sorry to put because we are getting some really good responses. We're going to move to some looking at the recommendations, and I'm bringing in initially Pam Duncan-Glancy, please. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you, convener, and thank you very much for the panel for answering the questions so far and for the information you've given us in advance. I'm really struck by the importance that you're all rightly placing on the role of teachers. Also, the point about some felt blocked. Professor Muir, your point about the distance of teachers from decision makers and how that is having an impact. On that basis, then, how could we ensure that all three elements of the diploma are applied consistently across schools and are manageable for schools to assess?
I think if I start with that and then I'll hand over to colleagues, but I think that it's a really important question. And I think the answer lies in the kind of collaborative approach that we've been describing. That this isn't about, you know, one or two people in a darkened room producing things that then go out to the world. This is about groups of schools working together with local and national agencies so that by being involved in the development of the next phase, you're actually building capacity across the country. You also need to target what it is you're looking at. So you need to be very clear about if you're looking for consistency across the country, then you design a system that will explore consistency across the country. So again, it's back to being very clear about what it is that you're setting out to achieve, and then designing approaches that work with people
recognising that different parts of the country, you know, will have different needs. So allowing the flexibility, but building the national standards so that there's a shared understanding across the country, and we build a sense of fairness there.
On that, are the current structures that exist fit to do that?
I think that there is no reason why we don't develop structures to do that. And again, I think, Duncan Glancy, it's the fact that once we're very clear about what it is that we're seeking to achieve, then we look at the structures to make sure that they facilitate these processes. So the danger, I think, one of the dangers with any innovation is that people think that once you've agreed the vision, you can then forget it, mm-hmm. and you get into the practice, mm-hmm. you know, when in fact we really need to change the way we think, mm-hmm. and that it's constantly about why are we doing this, and then it's the what, the how, and the when. But building that in, so therefore, once you're clear about the why, then it's, well, how do we make this happen, and how can the agencies come in to support that? So, for example, linking a point, and this is the last long answer I'll give, convener, I promise, but linking it into the point that you made, which is around, you know, we shouldn't all be starting from a blank sheet. No, teachers shouldn't all be starting from a blank sheet of paper. Mm-hmm. So there are things, for example, that it makes sense to do collectively. So if we take the project learning as an example of that, then we've got examples in the system already that we can begin to build from. Mm-hmm. But also, as part of that process, then we should have national agencies, curriculum and assessment qualifications, working collaboratively with groups of schools to develop examples of what project learning might look like that schools can then take and adapt into their own circumstances. So for those schools who are already doing that, they can build on what they're doing. For schools where some of these practices are more innovative, then they can build from examples rather than have everybody starting from the blank sheet of paper. And I think that is something that we learned from Higher Still.
Thank
Sorry.
Professor Muir, do you want to come in?
Yeah, just really to point out that not all three elements that are being proposed in the diploma are assessed. I mean, obviously, the programmes of learning are akin to what we currently have got at SCQF levels 6 and 7 at higher and advanced higher. The project learning, we're talking about teacher assessment with some kind of moderation, which is a pass-fail. But critically, the personal pathway is not assessed, but it's an important part of the proposed diploma, because in that is a record of the kinds of achievements that young people make throughout the learning experience, and it helps to change some of the culture and mindset that exists just now, that learning only really becomes important when you choose your subjects in setting their third year in school. So it's giving due recognition to the learning that takes place in early years and primary, and building on that throughout their school career.
Thank you. And just very briefly to move on to the subject you've already covered a little bit about, interdisciplinary working. To what degree do pupils already get opportunities to do that? And why do you think maybe the progress we should make on it has been a bit slower than expected?
I'll start this and then I'll hand over to Peter. But I think that the reality just now is that some pupils, some students do and some students don't. And I think that what we're, as an independent review panel, we're keen to establish is that that really isn't good enough. That this has to be, you know, every learner in the country has opportunities to develop these skills that are identified, to use the knowledge through skills in order to make sure that they're well supported into the next phase. If I go back to that old-fashioned watch idea, that just now, there are parts of the system so, for example, when students are in initial teacher education, much of their time, quite rightly, because that's the way the parameters are set just now, but is set within individual subjects. So they're supported for that particular role, but not in every institution. across the country, are they supported into working in ways that cross disciplines? And so for that interdisciplinary approach to take place, then people need to be supported to develop the skills that will allow them to do that. So it's one example of the way in which if one particular cog isn't moving, then you see the result in what happens in practice. Peter.
Okay, yeah. I'll be brief.
There you go.
We are so busy, schools are generally so busy trying to put as many hours and minutes and all our efforts into passing exams to prove that we're doing well and that the youngsters leave with a suite of qualifications that are viewed as good, albeit there could be alternative, better alternatives for them. So it's not that doing exams is bad necessarily. They're good if they acquire them, but they're bad if they weren't the right choices in the first place. And because we're spending so much time doing that, though, many of the times we're only doing interdisciplinary learning because the HMI are going to come in and assess us on it.
And do you think the government are... Do you have any concerns that the government are not going to take your recommendations on exams?
I think that once the Cabinet Secretary has gone through that second tier of listening, I would be hopeful that the bit of the profession that hasn't spoken positively about the SDA will support it, and therefore that the Cabinet Secretary and the Scottish Government will take forward the recommendations once they hear from everybody.
Thank you. And one final, very brief point. Do you think that it can be delivered, that the vision you've just described can be delivered within the classroom environment we have right now, classroom numbers, non-contact time? Do you think teachers could do that just now, or will that need to change?
I think, as Professor Hayward said earlier, that we need a systemic change, and that does begin by supporting teachers, not just through initial teacher education, which I think is fabulous these days, really producing great teachers coming out of that, but through that, the career and long, the CPD, the career and professional development that needs to happen in schools for those teachers who are currently in the system. If we understand what we're trying to achieve and we put in place robust support packages, then I'm pretty confident that we could do that, and the time will come from a review of the examination system. So if we're not just doing exams and practice prelims, and we trust teacher judgment based on the increased development of teachers' understanding of standards, all that time spent teaching to the test constantly could be transferred over to developing the skills and developing the opportunities for our young people.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think in terms of that line of questioning falls nicely to our next questioner, Stephanie Callaghan.
Yes, it does. Thank you very much, Convener. But just before I go into that part of it, just quite a short question here. When I was looking at recommendation 6, we've got that point that all three elements need to be covered, so the progress, the projects and the personal one as well. And that the diploma won't be awarded if all three aren't covered as well. So I was just a little bit concerned about any risks that there might be around that, particularly with, for example, perhaps a pupil who doesn't have a parent who's particularly supportive or hasn't had very great support from teachers and maybe missing out in that element.
I think the reason, Ms. Callaghan, why we said that was... If what we are proposing in the report is accepted as the way forward, then those three elements are fundamentally the drivers for some of the mindset and cultural shift that the system actually requires. Now, and that's very much why we have said that the three elements need to be there, because we see each of them as having an important role in changing from what we currently have, which is a very examination-driven system, to something that recognises wider achievement and better prepares children and young people for the kind of uncertainties of the future.
More about ensuring that part of it happens then, if you like.
It's very much designed to emphasise the some of the things that we've been talking about this morning that need to be in place in order to make it happen.
That's great, thank you. So I suppose moving to the practicalities of actually delivering the change in certainly we've heard about people speaking about culturally in this country as well. The 3 R's is such a huge thing, and it's something that we very much pride ourselves on. It's in the fabric of all of us. We all talk about education, have a real pride in it. But as well, a lot of people really, really don't like change. Now, I'm really interested, Peter, you spoke earlier as well about the fact that, you know, all the teachers that you've spoken to have really, really come on board with it, as well as young people, parents, educators and employers as well there. So I suppose it's about how do we make sure that those remaining people come on board then? How do we actually deliver that practically on the ground and create that space to develop the structures that do need to change and happen in our classrooms? And also, I suppose, to a degree as well, there was a mention of the media and the press early on as well. How do we kind of offer a bit of protection as well against there being an attack on that? And the fact that, you know, it's not these definitive qualifications that we can tick off at A, B or C, but making sure we open up and see the wider circle of it.
Peter, do you want to come in first on that?
Thank you, Ms. Gallan. Communication. Those that I said think that the Scottish Diploma for Achievement are a good idea have only said that once we've talked it through and they understand it and they understand how it all fits together. In order to give it resilience, we need to keep going with the collaborative approach, using all the stakeholders, as the independent review group did in the initial work. If we continue to talk to our parent bodies and our youngsters, and of course those in the schools and colleges, and ask their views as we tease out. I mentioned the phrase planning for implementation. That's not a formal phrase, that's just my way of trying to describe how we should move forward. We need to plan for implementation. If we think the principles are good and the SDA is worth moving forward with in its entirety, which most people I speak to after discussion think it is, then in planning for implementation, we need to keep stakeholder engagement. We need to keep involving them. And as Louis said earlier, not just put a bunch of people in a room and then come up with a bunch of papers. And if we do that, then we can positively go out to the media, whether they publish what we're finding or not is dependent on the individual paper, of course. But if we continue to promote collaboration, positive, practical, achievable aims in that implementation, then the communities will buy into it as they have the initial idea.
Professor Hayward's also want to respond to your question, Stephanie.
Thank you very much. I think
other professor, that's the right one. Yep.
I think also that we need to be creative and think about the ways in which we engage with people. I was struck by work that I was doing in Ireland where when they introduced work where there was a significant change, they developed a video that that was on television and in cinemas. That it was the story of Orla, and it was a cartoon where the young person went through the system. And it began from, why are we doing this, and what will it actually look like for your child? So I also think that we need to be creative in the way that we begin to engage with communities and think about who we're trying to engage in the process and the kinds of ways in which we're most likely to get to people. I think we've long moved beyond the position where we believe that the letter going home in the school bag is an effective way of communicating. I think we need to think about these things more carefully. And also I think that creativity also comes into the ideas of professional learning. You know, that there are, for some people, professional learning is still the course you go to, you know, or the event you attend. And I think reframing that to say that the professional learning is about the role that you play in taking the ideas forward, working with others, so that as teachers build their expertise, they can then share that expertise with other teachers. And so what you're doing is building capacity in the system at the same time as developing the ideas.
Just a very short one on the end of it there as well. So would part of that as well be possibly talking about the fact that there might foreseeably be a decrease in the number of NAT5s or higher subjects because young people are actually going in a direction that's much more suitable for them? Would that play quite a part in that?
That's absolutely right, because I think that we have to recognise that, I can't remember who said it, oh, I think it was Peter who said that, you know, some parents are still talking about O-levels, and those of us who are steeped in education are sometimes in danger of making assumptions about where the outside world is in relation to that. And I think it links also to your question about, you know, to what extent do people understand the system? And I think we have a responsibility in terms of that too. So to tackle some of the issues head on, you know, so when parents talking with the parental group, what are the issues that parents are likely to be concerned about? And then use that as the basis for thinking about how we communicate. So again, we develop our communication strategy with people that identifies the issues that matter to them, and then we match the communication strategy to that. So it's a more sophisticated way of looking, I think, at communication.
Can I come in with a practical example of that?
It's a short practical example, is that okay? Sorry,
right. Very short practical example. And it goes back to an issue we've already raised. In many schools across the country, in order to ensure that they keep up the percentage, the historical percentage of, say, National 5 pass rates, they will produce packs of materials for youngsters who are not engaging as fully as they would wish or we would wish, and we get them through qualifications, through spoon-feeding them. And that happens in every local authority, I would argue, not in every school, but across the country it happens, is possibly a better way to put it. If the head teacher is brave enough to see a reduction in the number or the percentage of National 5 passes and trade that off for ensuring that a large number of youngsters get experiences that will allow them to go straight into a job, whether that be an apprenticeship or a job in the local economy, that's worth seeing your percentage or your number of NAT5 passes going down, because instead of just putting them in a room and making them go through worksheets to get them to pass basic qualifications, these youngsters are going in the workplace better prepared, more work ready, and the employers are a lot happier, and so is the kids.
Okay, thank you. Willie Rennie, it's over to yourself now.
I'd be interested in your reaction to Fiona Robertson's comments last week at the committee. In particular, she said she warned about unintended consequences, particularly around equity and the personal pathway element. She went on, it would be important that such an SDA could benefit all learners, whatever their pathway, and particularly around equity and the personal pathway element. I'd quite like your response to that.
Professor Moore, do you want to come in first?
That is the very reason the SDA that we're proposing has those three elements in it, that you know, that we need a different kind of recognition of achievement than we currently have just now, which is heavily dominated by examination performance. And I think, you know, it's very easy to set out a list of risks in changing any system. I mean, my own personal view is that the bigger risk for us now is not changing the system, because we know that there are significant issues with it as it's currently set up, and we know that the kind of environment within which current children and young people and future generations are going into is going to be radically different to what we have just now. So the thinking behind the three elements is to try and ensure that young people are as well placed as they can be to deal with the kind of problems and issues and challenges that Scottish society and global society faces for the future. And in order to do that, we need a transformation in the curriculum that we offer and in how we assess and evaluate the performance and the achievements of young people as a result.
I suppose she's setting up that there's a tension, isn't there? I mean, there's tensions throughout this, I get all that. But there's a tension between the choice for those particular people going down a particular path and others, and that a choice might have to be made as to whose interests are put first. In other words, have we modelled, I mean, ultimately it's about the timetable, can we get the timetable to work? I mean, we're reducing teacher contact time, We've got extra elements that are going to be brought into the timetable. Have you modelled it? I know you're still at high principle level, but have you modelled it to see how it could look and what the compromises would be?
Peter.
Yes. It's modelled in a variety of schools right across the country. There's lots of examples where head teachers have come together and shared existing good practice of where I mentioned brave head teachers who are prepared to see a drop in the percentages. And they're doing that because they're facilitating and encouraging partnerships with other organisations, whether that's Outward Bound or Ocean Youth Trust, or perhaps it's local businesses and employers who are providing experiences best suited for the young people. And by doing that, that needs recorded somewhere, because they're not passing their hires or their Nat 5s. The personal pathway element of the SDA would allow some recognition of partnership, working, acquisition of skills and experiences. And that still needs teased out to exactly how that would work. But in principle, we do that just now, right across the country. And we share these experiences on an almost weekly basis.
Okay.
So I could give you practical examples if you want to contact me.
Thank you. Professor Hayward.
Just very briefly, because the issue of equity was one that we took incredibly seriously, as you'll see within the report. And we also, there are some aspects of education that where we are concerned with fairness, and others where, you know, almost we're prepared to turn a blind eye. So, for example, that we have an industry of tutors in Scotland, you know, who prepare learners for examinations. And is that an issue of fairness? You know, that there are issues around that that I think that we need to begin to explore. But the other thing that we asked ourselves as a committee, we had a very, very serious discussion around equity. And we realised that the qualification system, the assessment system, doesn't cause the inequity, but it does shine a light on it. And so we had an option. Either we had lifted up a stone, we either put the stone back down, or we addressed it. And so we then started conversations around, you know, what does it mean to have an education in Scotland, and to what should every learner be entitled? So in terms of the personal pathway, we made it very clear that this isn't about the number of the location of experiences, but it is about that every learner should have experiences that allow them to talk about the kinds of things that they're engaged in. So we decided not to put the stone back down, but actually to shine the light on it and to say, what is it to have an education in Scotland, and that these three parts of the experience are entitlements for every learner.
Michelle Thompson, thank you very much for waiting patiently. Can we bring yourself in now, please?
Thank you for a very engaging session thus far. I want to ask about artificial intelligence. They say AI is like quantum physics. If you claim you understand it, you're merely proving you don't. And Professor Hayward, of course, I note your recommendation 12 for the Scottish Government to establish a cross-sector commission urgently. First question, do you agree that it's vital that industry and academics, as well as practitioners and government, are involved in that? What key themes, briefly, would you like to see evaluate? And another of my question is there, in your opinion, a risk that some of the realised issues around AI, particularly in cheating, actually could push people back into the teaching to the exam to alleviate said cheating, rather than the much wider perspective that you've outlined throughout the course of this morning?
Okay, that's a really interesting question. And of course, artificial intelligence came out of the blue, in a sense, in midway through the review. I think that all countries just now are struggling to decide how to respond to artificial intelligence. That you'll know from the report that there were two fundamental views. One that said we should go back to tests and examinations because at least you can control those. And then another view, which came initially through the International Baccalaureate, that said actually the learners with whom we're working are going to have to live with artificial intelligence, and we have a responsibility to make sure that they're able to cope with that. Now, I think it may change the nature of tasks. So, for example, it becomes fundamentally important that learners are able to discern the difference between what is fake and what is real. And that's for all of us. Now, these are going to become not edges that are on the margins, but these are going to become fundamental skills. So, for example, it may change the nature of assessment tasks. There may be a task where you would ask, as an example, you would ask young people to perhaps generate a response using artificial intelligence. But the task would be for them to critique it, to identify what some element of dependable evidence within that, and where is their false news. So these are skills, I think, that we have to develop. I think it will change the nature of assessment tasks, but I think these approaches are going to be fundamental to what it is to be an educated citizen in the mid to late 21st century. Mm-hmm. And I think these are the issues that the government has to... I totally support your view that this is not an issue for education alone. It's again about bringing together the collective. And also learning, next week there is a meeting of countries from the Independent Education Assessment Network, where we're coming together to look at what's happening in relation to artificial intelligence from across these 12 nations. And I think it's that kind of... So learning, yes, within the country, but also learning beyond the country, because ultimately I think we have to deal with artificial intelligence.
On that point, do you think the fact that you even had these two kind of facets indicates still a relatively low level, regardless of where we are, whether it's government or you know, the wider practitioners, of exactly what both the threats and the opportunities are of artificial intelligence?
Absolutely. Okay. And I also think, therefore, that we need to involve in these discussions those who are at the leading edge. So the people who've been involved in developing the process need to be part of the discussion.
Thank you, Convener.
Ben McPherson, if we have.
Thank you, Convener. As well as being able to make sure that young people can consider sources and what's truth, is there also a need to make sure that our young people have the knowledge and skills to use AI and be able to utilise its opportunities? It's something that I think we perhaps need to talk more about.
That's a very important point, absolutely. I also think the same is true with teachers, if I reflect back into that, that from what I read of artificial intelligence, then there are significant opportunities, for example, for artificial intelligence to support with the reduction of some of the more bureaucratic tasks that teachers engage in just now. But that will only happen if teachers are supported to develop these skills and approaches. So it's identifying what the potential is and then making sure that the support mechanisms are in place to ensure that that potential is realised.
OK, thank you. Ross Greer, can we come to yourself now, please?
Thanks, Convener. I'm incredibly enthusiastic about the whole package of reform that you've proposed here, but I think it's probably fair to say that the element that's captured public attention the most is this question about the status of high-stakes end-of-term exams and alternative assessment methods. You've not prescribed exactly what some of those alternative methods could be in terms of what continuous assessment, etc., might look like. But to kind of illustrate what the options are, and to pick Ken's subject, if I'm 5 years from now, a 16-year-old taking geography, what could that assessment look like? If not the high-stakes end-of-term exam model, what might that experience be? What are the options available?
One thing just to... Thank you very much for your comments. One thing to make clear is that, you know, that we're not advocating the end of exams. You know, what we're saying is that you need a broad range of approaches to assessment, and an exam is one part of that, can be one part of that, but it's to broaden. But I'm going to hand over to Ken as the expert geographer to respond to your question.
Thanks, Mr. Geer. Yes, I mean, I think in geography, over the years, it's a subject area that's actually set some of the direction of travel through investigations and assignments that have been part and parcel of the examination system. Where they've tended to fall down, of course, has been in regard to the time that that takes to engage in some of these activities. But I think looking to the future, part of what I would see, for example, a geography curriculum comprising would not just be so-called pure geography, but engagement and offering opportunities for children to engage in some of the interdisciplinary learning that we're proposing through the project learning element of the SDA. And much more ongoing assessment and evaluation by children and young people of the skills that they themselves are developing. Because I think one of the criticisms that certainly I came across from students as well as practitioners when I was doing my report was that the opportunity to develop the kinds of skills and competencies that are felt necessary for the future weren't necessarily there within the curriculum. So, and that's one of the reasons why the project learning element is so important, because it gives the opportunity of developing these meta skills, working in collaboration and such like. And I would see that as being much more part of the curriculum, given that we're talking about potentially a two-year period over which to gain an SCQF level 6, for example, or higher, young people themselves will, through the personal pathway, will be identifying their development and expertise in some of these skills and competencies that currently the system doesn't necessarily include, and the curriculum doesn't necessarily include as formally as we feel it's necessary for the future. So, as Louise said, you know, we're not advocating the end of examinations. I mean, the programmes of learning are fundamentally what we see just now. But I think it's about how a subject area, any subject area, not just geography, but any subject area, offers the opportunities and to develop these other two elements of the SDA.
You've mentioned there some of the potentially new elements. To what extent, touching on what you said at the start of your answer, to what extent will this also just be about recognising work that has already taken place? So, for example, you mentioned some of the assessment project work that's already happening in geography, but that doesn't currently count towards the final grade a young person gets. How much of it is simply about bringing that into the mix for what actually makes up the collective assessment for their final grade? Because I think that would address some of the perfectly legitimate concerns that teachers have around workload, for example, that this isn't just about adding new stuff, it's about recognising some of the good work that's going on but is not currently making up what decides the grade, what goes on that SQA certificate at the end of the year.
As I said earlier, Mr. Geer, you know, this is not a situation where all three elements are examined. And I think that's an important part of the cultural shift that we're trying to generate through the SDA. But I think part of the answer to that, it goes back to something I said earlier about some of the activities that schools are already engaging in that demonstrate how the likes of project learning and the personal pathway can be developed. If you look at what the Vardy Foundation is doing, for example, with Gen Plus, you know, there's a perfectly good digital e-portfolio that's been developed as part of this, which encourage the young people who are engaged in that programme to reflect on their own learning and to evaluate where they are in terms of skills development and to use that to plan for the next steps in learning. So there are elements already in the system that I think could be built upon, and it's about building the confidence of teachers, which is where the whole professional learning CPD angle comes back in. It's about building teachers' confidence that even although many of them in secondary see themselves very much as subject experts, you know, part of that cultural shift is about how we prepare, how teachers prepare young people for a very different kind of world within which they're going to be living. And while the subject element's important, so too are the other elements that they recognise as learners, how they're developing and having a say in that as part of their learning journey.
Thanks very much. Sorry, Professor Hayward.
Thank you. Just to add one bit to that I think we were also struck in the discussions we had with young people about sometimes the weakness of the evidence base for the decisions that they were taking about the next stage in their lives. You know, we heard things like, well, I'm going to do X at college because it wasn't a subject at school, so it'll be new. Or, well, my dad did this, so I'm going to do the same. So the personal pathway is also about trying to encourage the conversations that allow learners to take better decisions about the kinds of next steps that they take in their own journeys.
Thanks very much. And if I could just touch on Willard Ennis' line of question, going back to the SQA, in terms of how this is taken forward and what specific proposals are adopted for taking forward your recommendations. If I could ask a two-part question, because one part's a bit provocative and you might not want to answer it. How credible can this be if the SQA in its current form takes a lead on making these decisions on what these new models of assessment might look like, what the balance of assessment might be? And the general question, if you want to sidestep that, though I'd urge you not to, who should government involve in this, the next step for making these quite specific decisions within each course about what the balance of assessment and what the models of assessment actually are based on your recommendations?
And these are tricky questions. Do you want to start with this one, Ken, or do you want me to?
I'm quite happy to offer my view on it. I think we, in Scotland, we have a single awarding body that sets the examinations and so on. I think in Scotland, as I said earlier, we have a heavily examination-driven system, and that includes the curriculum. And if you ask many teachers who is responsible for the curriculum, and certainly in secondary schools in Scotland, they will say it's basically the qualifications body. Personally, I don't think that is healthy, because there is a huge amount of expertise at the grassroots level that needs to be used much more effectively in determining what the curriculum looks like and how it changes and when it changes. And that the curriculum is simply not amended when a decision is taken to change the examinations. So I would be hopeful, and I hint at this in my report, I'd be hopeful that the proposal to create a new qualifications and awarding body would be one that is sympathetic to what we are proposing within the SDA, and that the activities and the engagement of that body with the wider system is at a high level, in order that the young people can benefit from the wider range of achievements, and not just the examination results, but the wider range of achievements that the education system in Scotland currently offers them, and arguably could offer much more consistently and in a better way in the future.
You deserve a lot of credit, Professor Muir, for being one of the driving forces behind the organisational reform that's now taking place. But realistically, we're probably 3 to 4 years away from having that new qualifications body established, bedded in and operational. I presume you wouldn't want us to wait until we've got the new body, hopefully with its new culture, before engaging in implementation of these recommendations. So that leaves us with the question of the current SQA and their role in taking this forward.
Well, as I understand it, the government are already moving forward on the introduction of a new qualifications and assessment body. I think the culture that body has is going to be very significant in ensuring the success or otherwise of what we're proposing in the SDA.
Thanks.
Can I bring in Liam Kerr with the final question, I think, looking at time? If we do get time up, I've got one.
Thank you, Convener. So qualifications, as they currently are, are key to monitoring how the system's performing. Professor Hayward, can a Scottish diploma of achievement meaningfully allow for similar such metrics to be gathered?
Yes, because I would argue that it will give a broader range of evidence that will allow that policymakers to consider the system. And I think to make reference to a point that Peter raised earlier, it would give the evidence in relation to every learner rather than to only a number of learners. So it's a more comprehensive basis of evidence. One of the issues that we raise in the report, but if you'll forgive me, that I think is outside our remit, but one of the issues that we did raise was a suggestion that that in future Scotland may wish to reconsider the idea of having a national survey, and that national surveys can give bodies like this very specific information related to specific questions. And it has the advantage in that because the evidence that is gathered doesn't identify individual schools, then you don't get the negative washback effects that Peter was describing. Mm-hmm. So in the longer term, then I think that whilst I think that the diploma will give the committees like this a broader evidence base on which to take decisions, but in the longer term, then I think thinking about alternative ways of providing evidence for policy communities would be worth serious consideration.
Grateful. It could be argued that exams or an examination system provides a kind of an objective benchmark against which people can be assessed that perhaps might not be there, arguably, with some kind of continuous assessment. So how could you ensure a parity of assessment process in a continuous assessment kind of framework where perhaps different or more subjective means of assessment by the assessors might be applied?
Okay, I'll start that and then I'm going to hand over to...
Time for more than one panel member to answer, so if you...
Can I make one comment?
Yes,
and then the research evidence suggests that we overestimate the dependability of external assessment and we underestimate the dependability of teacher assessment. The truth the truth lies somewhere in the middle, but there are cultural issues there that we need to address, and that's part of a communication strategy. Peter.
Exams. There's nothing wrong with assessment. Teachers need assessment because without assessment we're unable to determine whether they're working through the agreed programme of work and the acquisition of skills and knowledge that we need them to do. Teachers do assessment all the time. What's crucial to make that work in a continuous assessment model is more time and moderation. The people who mark the exam papers are teachers who are working in a variety of schools. They come together once a year. There would be nothing to say that a new qualifications agency didn't spend as much time doing exams, but spent a partial amount of time doing moderation activities where existing teachers carry out the same type of activity, but across the year. This would better benefit a number of youngsters who can't cope with being put in a big hall.
I want to try and bring Stephanie Callaghan in. She's promised me this is going to be a brief supplementary.
Yeah, so really looking for a yes or no answer here. Is this then about, would it be fair to say this is about a bit of a shift away from quantitative data and actually looking more at qualitative data that comes from teachers, the pupils, their experiences to get a better balance? Is that a fair comment?
It's a balance.
I think it's both.
Thank you.
Both quantitative and qualitative.
We've managed to get everybody in. Thank you. As ever, we come to a screeching halt when we could carry on the conversation for quite some time, and I really do want to thank the panel for their time today. The public part of our meeting is now concluded, and we'll consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you.